In light of recent events in Orlando, where 50 people were killed at the Latino night at the gay club Pulse, this podcast ended up being delayed and basically minuscule down to one episode after the event and conferences had passed. Due to the events, we didn't want to just go in and talk about how excited we are about shooting games immediately afterwards, because that's obviously not that totally appropriate. And I this is completely ad-libbed, but I just wanted to say that's why this was delayed, and I hope that you'll enjoy the podcast anyway. Welcome to the E3 podcast. It's Saturday. It's 2 days since E3 ended, but whatever, whatever. I'm your host, Andrea, and with me is Lottie.
Hi.
Hi. So we'll be talking about what we remember liked and didn't like about E3 this year, because there was a lot at E3 this year. It was packed, and we couldn't possibly include all of it in one episode. But yeah, without further ado, I mean, let's just dive right into it. Lottie, what's the first game you come to think of when you think of E3 2016?
Since I didn't really watch the conferences live, I think the thing that mainly sticks out in my brain is Dishonored 2. I mean, obviously it's not an announcement, and it we knew about it last year and stuff.
It was announced at last E3, I think.
Yeah,
Yeah.
but I'm just kind of surprised that they seem to find ways to sort of and again, I haven't watched it through. I sort of like skipped through the footage, but things like oh, I can't remember the name of the game that I'm thinking of. It's a side-scrolling game about rewiring security systems to sort of like slip past, and they've got like a power in the game now that's similar to that, where you can sort of chain abilities together, like between
Yeah.
people. So that seemed interesting, and then there's the timepiece. Way.
Yeah, that was really interesting to me. Basically, for those who might not know, Dishonored 2 is a sequel to a game called Dishonored, obviously. And it's a stealth assassination game. But in Dishonored 2, you get to pick between two different characters. There's Emily, and there's
Corvo.
Corvo, right. And it looks really cool, and they're introducing time travel now, which looked interesting, because you basically use this shard to look into the past or the future to see what is different, and basically utilize that for either stealth maneuvers or puzzles. It reminded me a bit of Skyward Sword, where there was a temple where you would shift back and
Oh
forth between the past and the
yeah, that
present.
was probably my favorite part of the game. And I'm a fan of like localized time manipulations and things like that. I mean, we had the one thing in Dishonored 1 where you could like freeze time and then like fire bullets, and then they would like you'd unfreeze time and then they would all fly.
Yeah.
Stuff like that, but yeah, it's obviously we're trying to explain it, but I think it works better when you actually see it, because then you're in sort of like it seemed to be like a more ruined version of the place,
Yeah.
and like on your wrist, you're looking through the shard and the timepiece.
It was a little like a singularity, where you would like go back into the restored part of this world to do something. I did like it. I hope that there's some limitations to it. Like, obviously you can't do anything that would cause a paradox, stuff like that. Because otherwise, it feels like it would be a bit too easy to do any bit of stealth. You can just phase out of that current time period,
Yeah,
like
it could be that.
at will.
Is it? I'm assuming it's probably limited by the energy.
Well, that as well, probably, yeah. But yeah, Dishonored 2 looks really cool. I'm liking the new place. I forget what it was called. I'm really liking Emily as clearly the intended main protagonist.
Yeah.
Like, yeah, you can still play as Corvo if you want, but like they're selling Emily as the lead, and that's cool for once.
Yeah.
Also at Bethesda's press conference, they showed where they announced a new Quake game, Quake Champions,
yeah.
Which of course I was very excited about. It's following in the veins of Quake 3 in that it's multiplayer focused without the single player campaign, and it's taking back characters from Quake 3 like Visor and Ranger, who is technically the Quake 1 guy, but still. They said it's going to feature character abilities, which has made some people worried. Mm-hmm. I'm still optimistic because I think that might be a good thing, because weapon switching and stuff like that is still going to be a thing. So as long as it's not fixed loadouts, I don't really mind something minor like a character power. Because I mean, really, at that point, if you don't like the character power, you just play with a character that has another character power. You know,
yeah.
If that's all it is, then that's cool.
So is this is PC only, isn't it?
PC only, yeah, which was surprising, and I think that was a really good thing to hear, because even though I really, really enjoy Doom, both Doom and Rage suffered from consoles. It suffered from being clearly aimed at functioning on consoles before PC, and as such, especially Doom, the PC version is all kinds of broken.
Mm.
And, like, the menus aren't built for PC, and, like when you're working in Snap Map, there can be three different confirm buttons, depending on what the menu has decided is currently the right keyboard combination for confirm. It's like, it's ridiculous.
Yeah, just quickly on the that character ability thing. Obviously, I don't know, we've not even seen footage of it, but I think I have confidence that they'll make it work, because obviously I thought, I didn't think it looked great on the last year's E3 podcast as well. But the melee glory kill stuff in Doom, I was very kind of against that. But yeah. Then I played the demo recently, and it fits a lot better than I thought it would. And it doesn't slow things down. So I don't know if that something that's changed since the E3 last year build?
It has. The glory kills in Doom improve a lot between E3 and release. It did work much better than it looked. And overall, I just have confidence in it. Like the first time I didn't have confidence in it was after last year's E3, and with Doom actually being good, that has been restored. So, yeah, I'm excited to see what they're going to show at QuakeCon in, I think, August. So that'll be exciting. Mm. I can't remember if they actually announced anything else, like that weren't just DLC at the Bethesda conference.
Well, it's obviously the remaster, but they announced Skyrim Special Edition.
Which, I mean, that's cool. Mods for console, yeah. Okay. Which, once again, makes me ask, why doesn't Doom have mod support? Mm. Yeah, they announced the Snap Map is going to get hell stuff and more demons. I'm like, oh, you're finally putting in the stuff that should have been there at start.
Mm.
And they're putting in a single-player option. Because right now, the single-player mode in Doom Snap Map is just you activate co-op multiplayer, but disable, like,
other players.
Yeah, or you set it as an arena shooter, and you just once again make it so everyone is forced to be the same team. Like it's ridiculous.
Another thing that I kind of skipped over, but you know, obviously, it's the thing of when you're not watching it live, and I'm trying to sort of like get the edited highlights. Prey was announced, which is not Prey 2, but
oh yes, that yeah. Okay, so. I had put on my bingo card, which I got a lot of points on that one, actually. I got no bingo this year, but I got a lot of points on it. But I put Prey 2 is finally revealed again. Because, of course, there was a rumor going around that Arklay was going to reveal Prey 2. It's been going around for a while now. And, yeah, Arklay revealed a new Prey. It's not Prey 2. And here's the thing. The game looks great. It looks to be a psychological sci-fi thriller. That's cool. I like the idea of that. But like, it's called Prey. Just Prey. There's only one other game in the series which is also called Prey. This has no connection to the previous Prey, from what I can tell. And it's not Prey 2. Why is this called Prey?
Should they have called it PR3Y?
No, they shouldn't. But like, why would you go with Prey? There's no brand awareness there that's
I
worthwhile.
mean,
And
it's
like,
10 years as well.
yeah, and like the only people who were asking for Prey 2 were asking for Prey 2 not because they liked Prey, but because Prey 2 looked fucking awesome.
Was Prey even that good? Because I have played it, and all I
Oh,
remember.
Prey is good. It's just not. It's not great.
Because all I
It's
really.
a decent little shooter.
Because I remember.
Yeah.
I'm still not sure I remember liking the death mechanic.
Yeah, you couldn't die. Like, whenever you died, you
Yeah,
just
it just.
respawned, and your health and spirit power depended on how many birds you could shoot in the afterlife or something. I mean, I get where they were going with that. I just kind of felt that this should have been a potential second wind mechanic rather than a permanent one, at least on the higher difficulties. But I mean, I liked Prey. I liked Prey up until you started flying around in vehicles. Because that was a pain. But otherwise, it was fun. The weapons were really fun. The bosses were fun. The enemies had great designs. And just overall, the soundtrack was great. Like, I liked Prey. And I wanted Prey 2. Because Prey 2, while it didn't look at all like Prey, it looked like a very, very, very good, sci-fi shooter. And now Prey 2 doesn't exist anymore. And we have a new game called Prey. And it's like, but no one asked for a Prey
Well,
reboot.
maybe we will get Prey 2 after this one.
Oh yeah, that would make sense. No, but that game did look good. I mean, like, I'm not gonna shit on the game itself. I'm just really upset about Bethesda's naming conventions again. Just like they call Doom and not Doom 4. But yeah, but I think that was basically it for Bethesda. Like, they had a decent little showing, I suppose. Like, I didn't care for the DLC much. I didn't care for the Elder Scrolls Legends. They kept saying that Elder Scrolls Online was voted the best MMO of last year, and I'm like, says
I think
who?
they might have been talking specifically about Tamriel Unlimited, which is like.
Yeah, but that's the thing. Like, if you can count that, then Heavensward counts, and that means no one called it the best MMO of last year.
I would have thought, though. Yeah. Because it's. I don't know. I played it and I like it. But then I didn't pay that much for it. I got it in a sale.
I mean, I still like the thing with Elder Scrolls Online for me is that I got the fucking beta access to that game. Like, I got the beta before it released, and I still sometimes get surprised by it existing. Like, I will spot it in a store and go, Elder Scrolls Online? Oh yeah, that exists. That released. 'Cause it's just such a pointless game.
I know we're sorry, I know we're getting sidetracked, but the did it not because I remember people telling me that it didn't feel like an Elder Scrolls game back then.
Well, I mean, it depends on what you mean. I mean, when it was first announced, it did not. But, like, then they got the first backlash, and they were like, oh, it's totally an Elder Scrolls game. Look, now it's first person that has a stamina meter. It's like, oh, okay. Thanks. So it's like, oh, look, see, you have to aim and attack, like, in real time. But, like, the arrows kind of bend a bit because it's actually just designating attacks, and, it's just. It's like, it smokes and mirrors, and I'm fine with that. Problem is that anyone who like is really into Elder Scrolls lore just looks at that game and goes, no. No, there's a reason we're moving forward in Elder Scrolls lore. Going back, it doesn't work. We can't tamper with the past.
Oh, and just a quick side thing. I've been trying to get into Morrowind on like the Xbox version.
Yeah.
There's a lot of things I like.
The loading times on the Xbox version.
Oh my! Oh yeah. The thing. What was it? The person who dies very early on. They fall out of the sky and they drop.
Oh yeah, that's an Easter egg. Yeah.
Yeah. I picked that up. I did the jump.
Yeah.
And then it was like six or seven loading screens before I landed, I think.
Yeah. Did you survive?
I did, because I landed in water.
Oh, okay, yeah. If you land on water, or if you land high up enough that you don't reach falling damage that will kill you,
yeah.
You will survive. Although, you can also survive by activating the second scroll right before you land. Because what it does, it ups your acrobatics to the point where you will not take falling damage from the fall. But it's normally used up when you jump. Which means that you can jump twice, but you can't land twice.
Yeah.
Which is great. But yeah, I like that little Easter egg. I love Morrowind. I actually honestly think that Morrowind Special Edition would have been a better thing to do first.
Yeah.
Because that game could use a remastering.
Mm.
But moving on from Bethesda stuff, I suppose that if we're going to move from conference to conference, we might as well jump into EA.
Yeah.
Which was a bunch of nothing.
Mm.
EA did not show fucking anything.
I mean, they definitely didn't show that Battlefront thing that they just announced.
Yeah, they did, yeah. Today they announced Battlefront DLC, which looks fine, and they didn't show that at
E3.
Yeah. But they didn't... Okay, so what did they show? Like, they showed... They announced one game.
Mm.
They announced one game. It was a Swedish-developed indie game called Fear, and which is Swedish for fairy.
Mm.
And that looked cute, looked fine. But like, anything else was like, oh, here's Battlefield 1. Here's... what's that other shooter we're doing? Titanfall 2, which we announced like a month ago for some reason.
Mm.
And, you know, Titanfall 2, I mean, I guess it looks okay. But I'm just feeling like, oh, well, it's Titanfall. People are going to play for a week and then they won't play it anymore.
Yeah.
Like, oh, we have a single-player campaign this time. I'm like, well, I don't think that's going to make people play it longer.
No. See, I liked Titanfall.
Everyone did, didn't they? Like...
I think that
it got great reviews and stuff. Like everyone was like super hyped for it and loved it when it came out, and then it just went dead immediately.
I think the problem for me is that I have like limited space that I can actually use to run it, and and it was just like 50 gigabytes of gun sounds. So it was like, you know, it was just like this massive hog. Of space, like
that Source Engine too, for some reason,
which meant that I could run it.
Yeah, and the new one is on Frostbite.
Oh, right. So I would won't be able to,
because EA can basically rename themselves to Frostbite Studios at this point. Like everything they're doing is on Frostbite. But no, I don't think they even announced any PopCap stuff. Like there was no Plants vs Zombies things.
Mm.
Like
no,
yeah,
Peggle 3.
No, Peggle
3. Peggle 3.
Peggle 2 is still the best announcement at any EA conference. That was fucking amazing. But, like, I'm sitting here trying to think, like, and I know they only announced one game, because that's been pointed out by everyone, like, oh, they only announced one game. But, like, I'm pretty sure they showed more games, didn't they?
Did you also notice that they didn't actually have a conference there at E3?
They had one in Los Angeles and one in London, wasn't it?
Yeah, but as far as I could tell, they got people in like a convention hall type thing, and then they live streamed footage.
Yeah, and they kept switching back and forth between London and Los Angeles. But like, you had like what's his name? The EA guy,
Peter Moore. Am I right?
Peter Moore was in London, wasn't he?
Yeah.
Yeah, with the guy in the US. I can't remember his name. Anyway, he was standing like people were seated behind him. Like they had like tables behind where he was standing. I'm like, wait, what? Why?
Yeah.
But you couldn't get a stage. Really, EA? How cheap are you?
Yeah.
But yeah, I don't know. I mean, Battlefield 1 looks fine. It looks like Battlefield 1942, but in HD.
Or to me, it
And
looks
I
like
mean,
COD 3.
but yeah, it just looks like a World War II shooter. And they're like, oh, it's World War I. It's so different because,
Yeah.
well, there are airships. Like, oh, okay. Well, I guess that's cool.
Yeah.
But I mean, it looks fine. It looks fine. I'm probably gonna play it eventually, but like, I couldn't get hyped for it.
Speaking of which, sorry, another tangent. EA's got a sale on PSN at the moment.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and you've played the last two battle. You've at least played Battlefield 4, haven't you? I don't know if you played Hardline.
I play Hardline. Yeah, I play all Battlefield games actually.
Both of those are on PSN for $3.99. Is that a good?
Oh my God.
Is that
Hardline is garbage.
Hardline's gone.
Hardline is awful. Four is alright. I mean, it's basically Battlefield 3 with some patches. Like, that's the thing. Like, oh, we're not gonna patch Battlefield 3. We're just gonna release a sequel instead. I feel that's what one's gonna be. It's gonna be Battlefield 4 with like a skin pack and slightly less bugs. But you know what? I'll take it. I won't take it full price. I'll wait for all the DLC to come out probably, but you know, I'll take it.
The only games I've pl what I've played Bad Company 2 in Vietnam.
Oh, okay, actually, Bad Company 2 is the only one I haven't played, actually, now that I think about it. I heard the multiplayer was really good in that.
Yeah, it was great. But then because the problem was it was the last one to kind of, well, I've only ever played those two. It ran well on consoles at least.
Yeah.
The problem was that when 3 came out, and then everyone was like, oh, don't buy it on consoles, buy it on PC. And then I bought it on PC and I can't run it. Well, I can run it. I run it at like 19 frames a second.
Yeah, I mean, you can play Battlefield 3 on PS3. I mean, that's what I did before I had a PC that could run it, because it's fine on PS3. It's a good game. Like, that's the thing. I like the Battlefield games. They're nothing special anymore. Like, they really are just the same game over and over. But like, that's fine. They're still fun.
Yeah, I guess.
Yeah, I don't know. Battlefield 1 looks. It looks okay.
Yeah.
It's not as pretty as the trailer is.
No, definitely
Like,
not
it was so funny how
when
everyone was going like, oh my God, this is in-engine footage. I'm like, it's not going to be in-engine footage. Like, oh no, it is. It's absolutely in-game footage. And then like, they have an in-game trailer that actually cuts to gameplay, and you can see like just perfectly the split second it cuts to gameplay. Like, the visual quality just drops. It's like, well then.
Oh, and from last year's E3, did that sorry, keep
Go
getting sidetracked.
ahead.
Did
Who cares?
that PGA Tour game with the battleship?
Oh my God, I
Did
forgot
that
about
actually
that.
release? I think it might have released.
I have no idea.
I'll
I have no. I forgot about that. But yeah, of
PGA
course, EA
Tour.
Sports was there, and FIFA and Madden are on. Frostbite. FIFA has a fucking. Well, it was FIFA or Madden has a fucking single player RPG mode. With like a story and like Telltale-esque like decisions and outcomes and shit. And it's like, wait, why? I mean, I'll be honest, it's the first thing that's made me interested in a football game. It's like, well, okay, I guess I could play this and kind of enjoy it. But yeah, I mean, that was EA. They had a Star Wars thing where, like, basically, I almost said Anita Sarkeesian. That's not at all what I was gonna say. What's her name? The other woman that the internet hates.
There's too
What's her
many.
name? Jade Raymond.
Jade Raymond,
Jade Raymond.
yes.
Yeah, she came out on stage and she was like, "Hey guys, Star Wars, right?" And then she walked off stage. And then they showed up. Like, that was it. She came on stage. They had. They've only had white men on stage, and then suddenly, like, Jade Raymond comes out like Star Wars, and she left the stage. And then they showed a reel of like people working on Star Wars, but not actually showing the games, except for like 5 seconds of a guy walking out of a door,
Speaking.
and people were like, oh my God, this is the Star Wars I've waited for. I'm like, It's a guy walking out of a door.
Speaking of not showing people working on games, Criterion.
Criterion, yeah. So I had one thing on my bingo board here. I had Criterion Games Extreme Sports Game is still missing in action. I did misspell it as supports, not sports, yeah. But still. Yeah, the Criterion Extreme Sports Game announced 2 years ago, E3, probably cancelled. And I say that because not only has it been missing 2 years in a row, but Criterion was listed as a Star Wars developer now.
Oh.
Yeah, so Criterion is probably doing the vehicles for the next Battlefront. That's my prediction now.
It could be that. It could be...
But you know, that's, could... that, at least we'll get good vehicles then.
Yeah.
Unlike Battlefront.
Yeah.
But yeah, that's a shame. So after EA, I guess we'll hop on to Ubisoft.
Ubisoft, yes.
Actually, before we do, let me speak one more thing about Battlefield 1, because I know people are going to want me to comment on this. So there was a former developer at DICE came out talking about the pitch history of Battlefield 1 and basically confirmed that the reason there aren't any female soldiers in the multiplayer is because boys wouldn't find it realistic. Which, of course, is kind of insulting since there were women who fought in World War I. So, good job, EA. Good job.
Yeah.
Anyway, yeah, Ubisoft.
Yeah.
I don't know what I can say about Ubisoft because Ubisoft's conference made me feel really sad.
Hmm.
How much of it did you see?
I didn't see any of it.
Oh my god. Okay.
So I saw pictures of the intro.
Yeah.
And then okay, immediately went into talking about, you know, the travesty that happened recently.
Yeah, so basically, I mean, if you want to talk like tone, because like all the streams and stuff from E3 started with one of the higher ups, often the CEO.
Except for EA.
Speaking about the tragedy in Orlando. And I was personally fine with that.
Yeah.
The only people who didn't know was EA. Which, you know, doesn't that sum up EA?
But then again, at the same time...
Actually, wait.
I'm sorry.
EA did it. EA did. Oh. EA did. I'm sorry. Bethesda didn't do it. That was it. I'm sorry, yeah. EA. That was my bad. I just remember the first one didn't do it. I forgot Bethesda had a conference for a second.
Mm.
But anyway, so Ubisoft, they start off with, like, people coming on stage doing, like all dressed up, starting dancing to Queen's Don't Stop Me Now.
Mm.
And it's a promotion for Just Dance 2017, by the way. The first game announced for the NX.
Yeah.
But Ubisoft already needs to put everything they have on the NX launch. Because that's what they do every console launch.
Yeah.
But it evolves into this gigantic clusterfuck of colors and shapes and animals and costumes. And it's ridiculous. Like, everyone was just, like, quoting images of it with WTF and nothing else.
Yeah.
And then afterwards, all this ends. Just stops. It doesn't even fade out. It just, like, stops.
Mm.
And Alicia Tyler or Taylor?
Tyler, right? Yeah.
Yeah, Alicia Tyler comes out of stage and it's like, this is going to be awkward. She starts by saying, this is going to be awkward.
Mm.
And then she goes and talks about the tragedy. I'm like, you couldn't do that before the gigantic, colorful song number?
Mm.
Really? But fine. So then they start showing things off. And the first thing they show off is Ghost Recon Wildlands.
Oh, yeah.
I am so uncomfortable about this game.
Yeah.
If you don't know what Ghost Recon Wildlands is, basically it's a alternate reality in which...
Bolivia?
Yeah, Bolivia. I was trying to remember the name and it was like... I was going to say Libya at first, but no, it's not Libya. It's like, oh yeah, it's Bolivia. So it's an alternate view where Bolivia is the number one drug manufacturer and exporter in the world, which, by the way, isn't true.
No.
But anyway, and because of this, the US decided it's a worldwide crisis. Yes, the US decides it's a worldwide crisis and sends in four Americans to basically manipulate, torture, and kill people in Bolivia to stop the drug cartel. And it doesn't matter how many civilians are hurt or killed while doing this, by the way, because as long as you stop the drug cartel, you did the right thing. And I know people don't like politics in gaming, but here's the thing. The game is presenting this as heroic actions. Last E3, we saw the four Ghost Recon people literally leaving the guy that we're supposed to like deal with to be caught by his superiors so that they could torture him. Like, in this really graphic scene, so that they could be led to his boss, basically. And in this year, we have them like stealing vehicles from civilians and just shooting and blowing shit up everywhere, just making the world's most disastrous scene. And all of it, never once just like, is there any like wink at the camera going, yeah, this is satire, or like, yeah, this is about how awful America is. No, this is all brouhaha. Look how heroic American recons are in Bolivia right now. And it's like, it's so uncomfortable. And there's not a single Bolivian person who is so far at least presented who is like a good person. They're all awful, monstrous people. Like, oh, this guy, he like he's a drug dealer, which means that he kills people and dissolves their corpses in acid. Because I guess that's part of being a drug dealer now, and that's who they're gonna get. And it's just ridiculous, and it was so uncomfortable to watch, and it makes me think, because like, Ghost Recon started as a slow-paced tactical shooter, a very slow-paced tactical hard fucking shooter.
Yep.
And then, in order to make it more interesting, they made a futuristic shooter, which still with the tactical elements applied.
Yeah.
Now none of that is in place.
No, it's just
Now it's a
an.
4-player co-op open world MMO shooter. It can't even be called MMO because it's 4-player, but like they keep just throwing buzzwords around. Set in modern day where you shoot and kill people. It's GTA, except they're saying you're the good guys.
Yeah.
And it's like, God damn it, that's just so uncomfortable. Like, I've played games where I'm the bad guy. I don't mind that. I love Kane and Lynch for fuck's sake. But because the games in Kane and Lynch never once do they stop and say, Man, you know, that Lynch guy. Good guy, right? No, you're a bad person. You know that. The game makes that clear. Similarly, like in Splinter Cell, when you are Sam Fisher, Spencer Conviction, and you are torturing a man, it doesn't feel like what you're doing is right. What you're doing is desperation out of this personal thing you have about your daughter being murdered. Like, it's meant to be an exaggerated act of violence done in desperation. And that works as a result. Here is just contextless entirely. It's just, yeah, you are the good guys. Everyone in this world is a bad guy. Just fucking kill them, I guess.
I think the thing for me, having, I didn't see it all because because I knew it would be uncomfortable. I've played The Division.
Oh yeah, I haven't, but
I
I've heard so many uncomfortable things about the division.
yeah, I could rip it to shreds. It's really horrible. You'll find. I think the term they use for them, or didn't Aisha actually call that out at one point during the thing I heard? Like she said that, oh, isn't it like they showed The Division and she said, oh, isn't it terrible the way all these looters are attacking you when you're trying to loot things?
Maybe she did. I don't know. I kind of zoned out when they talked about Division.
I don't think that there has ever been a less like a more inappropriate setting for an MMO than post Directive 51 New York. Just the thing of like the way that they spawn it is black people, basically. They just spawn black people over the like the dead bodies of people they've just killed, and that's just like the common thing.
Oh wow!
Yes.
Yeah, because basically what I was told was like, oh yeah, division is basically you going in and killing people for trying to survive.
Yeah. Yes. So firstly, you're fighting them for survival crimes, basically. But it tends to be like, oh, but it's because they, you know, they didn't actually loot places usually. It is just that they stole it from people. But then they go like the weird sort of direction, because it's like a gang of former sanitation workers who use flamethrowers, who are kind of like, it's just so weirdly inconsistent. It's like, because you know, like the way that at the beginning of the Assassin's Creed games, they say like, oh, this is made by a team of multiple faiths and whatever. It's like, it's very much a game designed by committee, but some people on that committee are very right wing. Like, it's like one or two of them are.
Well, it's kind of interesting, because like it's made by Swedish people, and it's made by I forget the Massive. Actual name of the studio.
Massive,
yeah. And like that was one of the reasons I was, because I was never really positive on The Division, because I thought it looked bullshit. But one thing I thought we were gonna get right was like, well, you know, at least it's not going to be Americans, you know, like painting up America as like with like a false sense of perspective in that way, like, but no, it turns out that we are doing the same thing, poor people are bad people kind of thing.
Yeah,
so okay, fine, great, good job, Sweden. But Division is getting DLC, that was announced.
Yeah, see, this is the problem.
Did I say like that? It's getting dungeons or something, like subway dungeons. Yeah,
but, sorry, it's a bit difficult, because obviously, while there are a lot of things I dislike about The Division, the way the season passes worked is that they've done two free content patches that go for everyone. And each one of those has included what they call incursions, which are kind of like raids, but not good enough. Imagine something that slightly resembles a raid, but is probably more like Gears of War Horde mode kind of level.
Oh.
So it's like a very high difficulty level kind of challenge mode. More or less, because this is the problem, is that I didn't like that it's a very slow progression through the game, and I didn't like that. But when I spent 48 hours in the game and got to the end game, and I listened to podcasts, I kind of enjoyed it. It's one of those kind of things. It's like, if you need something to keep you occupied, it can be an all right game.
that just ties back into Ghost Recon, because like from a gameplay perspective, it just looks like an okay open world shooter.
Mm.
Like I could see that being fun. It's the actual context of it that's uncomfortable.
Yeah,
it's
completely tone deaf. It is in that sort of bracket with both of those are sort of in that bracket with Battlefield Hardline, pretty much.
Yeah. And then there's Watch Dogs 2.
Oh, and speaking of which, I was just looking on Amazon before because I'm getting like recommendations and stuff, and each of them have like they've got loads of the E3 like placeholder box art,
yeah,
things, and I've noticed that both like with The Division, both Ghost Recon and Watch Dogs 2 have what they're calling gold editions.
Oh yeah, I've seen the gold editions.
Which
yeah.
means that they're selling them with the season pass for like an extra £35.
Yeah.
Which is, yeah.
The Ubisoft gold edition box arts are ugly.
Mm.
They've just taken the regular box up and made parts of it gold.
Yeah.
But no, Watch Dogs 2. So this wasn't the next game in the order, but I want to talk about Watch Dogs 2 next because of the context. So Watch Dogs 2, they actually had a chance to sort of fix the politics of the first game.
Because
that game also had fucked up politics.
This is amazing, though, from what I've heard.
Oh, yes.
Because, isn't it, he gets wrongfully accused of a crime.
Let's go through this. So, in Watch Dogs 2, you play Marcus, who, as the angry Steam forums have pointed out, is black, and therefore the game is pushing a social justice agenda.
Yeah.
But, you know, whatever. So, you play Marcus, who is wrongfully accused of a hacking crime. Okay.
This is the Need for Speed movie again, isn't it?
It's the Need for Speed movie again. Yes. Like, you get wrongfully accused of something, and in order to get back at being wrongfully accused, you go out and do the thing you're accused of doing. You start hacking. And here's the best part. Not only is he hacking for this DedSec group, he wears a DedSec cap.
Yeah.
And he has, like, the word hacker on his laptop he hacks on.
Yeah.
it's like, how are people not catching the actual hackers in this world? But okay, like, fine. So you want to get back at people for hacking, so you're going to hack things. Then. Okay, fine. You're going to hack the corporate people. Fine. Here's the problem. You can use all these tools to wrongfully have other people, civilians in the game, and randomly accused of crimes to get away with your own crimes.
Yeah.
It's the biggest hypocrisy simulator I've seen.
Yeah. So
I mean, it looks okay. I mean, that's the problem. Like, the first Watch Dogs, it wowed everyone with its, like, oh my god, look, he could manipulate the traffic light, and then everyone crashed, and then he ran away in a car. Like, that's what people remember. Because he was cool. And, of course, the blackout of the city. The thing is, like, now we have seen that, now we can't be wowed by that again. And we know how bullshit Ubisoft's gameplay trailers are. But the fact that Watch Dogs 2 didn't visually look that amazing and didn't really do any wow moment at all just made Watch Dogs 2's big gameplay reveal just kind of be, oh, okay, so it's Watch Dogs.
See my problem with Watch Dogs, I guess, the first one, was that the trailer made it look like open world Deus Ex, but the game is more like cyberpunk, slightly cyberpunk GTA, and that is not a thing that I was interested in. I know it's going to sound whiny entitled, but I got with my PS4, I got Watch Dogs and The Last of Us Remastered for free, and I didn't like either of them.
Oh really?
Yeah.
I haven't played Last of Us yet, but
it's the Naughty Dog the Naughty Dog problems of.
Well, I've heard headshots don't kill.
Yeah, well, right. I'll just quickly relay this anecdote of, like, when I tried to play it again, like, to try and get back into it a month ago. I'm in a building that I'm trying to escape from, and there are the clickers going around. So I'm going around in the shadows trying to hide from them. And then my one of the people in my group, like, runs directly in front of one of them. So I'm like, oh right, well, so that must be okay then. As long as I don't if I go into contact with them, and as long as I move slowly, I should be fine. But in any case, what happened was I moved past one, and then I instantly died because they've evidently got, like, for, like, an ease of use kind of thing, they've made it so that all the companions are invincible.
Oh.
Yeah. So it led me to believe things were wrong, were different from.
I played The Last of Us LARPing a few months ago now. I was at a convention and they had, like, this setup where they had, like, people who work with special effects and stuff had, like, used makeup and, like, made people clickers, and like made dead bodies around this school building we were in. We had to go around and look for gas masks and stuff, and it was fucking awesome. Best I ever played a game. But
Sorry, could I...
yeah. But anyway, so Watch Dogs 2. It looks like Watch Dogs, but you can fly a drone now, I guess. Okay, cool.
All right, so
And actually, there was one interesting thing. Like for a second, I was interested in Watch Dogs 2,
yeah.
because when things finally go to shit, then and Marcus pulls a gun out, it's a taser.
Yeah.
And he shoots the guy with a taser gun, and I'm like, oh, if Marcus is going to be a non-lethal character, that would be a really interesting thing. So like you play a person who will not kill. That changes a lot about the moral thing. And then like a second later, the guy pushes right on the D-pad, it's like assault rifle, motherfucker, and just shoots everyone. It's like, oh, okay. Never mind. I guess it's just Ubisoft game again.
So, what do you think about Steep?
Steep, I actually thought looked really good. I mean, I like snowboard games. I might like skiing games. I don't know. And the snow effects were really pretty.
Yeah, I've actually been skiing a couple of times, and so I haven't yet found a game that sort of replicates the feeling of being on a mountain, I don't think. It's difficult to explain.
Have you played Snow, I think it's called.
Snow.
It's meant for VR, but I think you can play without it. It's on Steam. It actually looked a lot like Steep.
The thing I'm thinking of is, I don't know, it's just like the way that it kind of feels like sort of a connected community there.
Yeah.
Like with them, like you go partway down and there's like a little bar and you can just hang out there all day.
Yeah.
And
It looked cozy.
yeah.
I liked Steep. Steep was probably my Ubisoft highlight. Like, I thought that looked kind of fun. And like I said, the snow looked so pretty. Like, the trails in the snow were so pretty to look at. And like someone pointed out, you could never go snowboarding and skiing in snow that thick.
Yeah.
That makes no sense. I'm like, shut up. I'm
Mm-hmm.
liking the trails in the snow. Fuck off. They're pretty. But yeah, that did look good. And I'm like, it was nice to see an Ubisoft game that didn't involve killing people.
Yeah.
Oh my god. I'm trying to think if there was any other Ubisoft thing before we get to the one I don't want to talk about but have to
Yeah,
talk
we
about.
don't have to talk about it.
No, I do. I do.
But
But I'm trying to think if there was any other one first. Fuck, was that it? Maybe?
I think so.
I feel like they announced something more.
Oh, grow up.
Oh yeah, the sequel to Grow Home, Grow Up is coming. Well, that's cool. I heard really good things about the first one. I own it. I haven't played it.
Yeah, I'm in the same boat. I got it on PS Plus a while back and I haven't got round to it.
Yeah.
So yeah,
Okay.
the
So, the second game of the show
one.
was South Park: The Fractured But Whole.
Yeah.
And I used to like South Park a lot. And I'm not gonna say South Park has gotten worse.
No.
I'm not even gonna say South Park has changed. I think South Park hasn't changed, probably. That might actually be it. But I have changed.
Yeah.
I don't like South Park. I find South Park as a very unrealistic, naive sense of how the world works. And its sense of progressive nature is just as naive.
Yeah.
I feel that it thinks that it's basically the hashtag satire of comedy. Hey, we said it was a joke. Why are you offended?
Yeah.
That kind of thing. And I'm not gonna say anything bad about people who like South Park,
I will.
but you can't have a conference in which you introduce it by offering sympathies and acknowledging the shooting the mass shooting at a gay bar and then have a presentation involving repeated uses of the Kanye West gay fish joke. You can't. That is in no way acceptable. You can't do a gay joke after you claim to have any sort of sympathies for that. You can't. And they did. And then they moved on to other things, such as, oh, in this game you can beat up not conventionally attractive sex workers.
Yeah.
Wouldn't be surprised if the reason they aren't conventionally attractive is because some of them might be trans women. Would not surprise me. After all, that's what GTA does, so why not?
Yeah.
That was part of the gag. You had, of course, the PC principal come out at the end because, you know, haha, hasn't political correctness gone far too far, you know, after all. We acknowledged a mass shooting earlier.
I think what...
You can't do this. You can't do this. The moment Ubisoft decided, yeah, we're going to acknowledge this, they should have said, yeah, Matt and Trey, we can't have these things. And I know they probably ad-libbed a lot of it. But if Ubisoft can't even, like, have serious contracts involving what they can say and not say, that they're going to take seriously, then you know what? Don't fucking pretend, even. And I've been meaning to do a bigger post about this, because because it's something that needs to be talked about.
Yeah.
How companies... they so want to support us when they can use it for PR, and then they will show us aside the moment they can do anything else. And it's not just E3. It's not just the Orlando shooting. It's not just this week. It's all the time. And just the Ubisoft software presentation was the perfect example to me on just how video game companies, no matter where they're from, don't give a fuck about minorities. And I'll be honest, like, that presentation left me in such an uncomfortable and sad state from the first two games they showed. Well, Just Dance was the first one, but the second and third games they showed, that, like, even though I did like Steep, I was surprised I was able to even, like, find the energy to enjoy that, because I was barely looking at the conference after that. Like, I was just completely zoned out of it. So, yeah. Oh, yeah. Before we leave Ubisoft, they announced Assassin's Creed is going mega multi-platform or something. So it's coming to this new video game platform called Movies.
Oh, yeah.
They actually referred to becoming a movie as going multi-platform. And as such, I counted my bingo box saying Assassin's Creed movie tie-in game.
Yeah.
Because, hello, the movie is a tie-in game, obviously. Ubisoft said so.
Yeah.
And they announced a Division movie because no one wanted that.
And the Watch Dogs movie.
Oh, yeah, sorry. That was what they announced. Yeah, Watch Dogs.
They'd already announced the Division movie.
They already announced the Division movie. That's correct. Oh, my God. Please wait to see how Assassin's Creed turned out. Please.
Can I just clarify? Because I can't remember whether this was a joke someone made or if it is true. Is the Assassin's Creed movie part of a trilogy?
I don't know. I just know it's like a separate but canon story or something.
Mm.
It might be part of a trilogy. I have no idea.
Mm.
But okay, so...
So that was...
Those were the third-party presentations.
Yeah.
Square Enix had Square Enix Presents, but... they didn't really announce anything there, I think. Everything they announced was either at another press conference or announced before E3, like the Final Fantasy XII remaster. Fuck yeah.
Speaking of which, of Square Enix, I didn't realize quite how soon I Am Setsuna was coming out.
It's next week, right?
Is it? I thought it was next. Oh, I'll just double check. I thought it was either. It's definitely in the next month or so.
It's soon. It's very soon.
Yeah.
And it looks great. I am assuming it looks really great.
Yeah, July the 19th of July.
Okay. Yeah.
So. So yeah, that. Which is strange because it kind of looks. Well, it's kind of very similar to sort of like the PS1 era Final Fantasies, at least
yeah,
in how definitely. It looks, but which is... Oh, right, so there's a Vita version.
Yeah, it's Vita and PS4 and PC.
Yeah, because I only knew about the PS4 version. Yeah, interesting. Who is it who's doing it? It's just... Tokyo RPG Factory, right?
Yeah, the studio that was announced at last year's E3.
Mm. But then again, because everyone was like, there's no way that they're going to actually have the game out by when they say they will, and they seemingly are.
Yeah, I mean, it's been out in Japan for a while now, hasn't it?
Yeah, February.
Yeah, I heard good things about it. I'm looking forward to it.
Yeah.
I don't think it's... I mean, I'm not going to be able to play when it comes out because I'm out of town, but
yeah.
I'll definitely play when I get back home, so that'll be fun.
Yeah, it's not going to... I doubt it's going to be better than Bravely Second was for me, but you know, I am still excited. Yeah. I do like PS1, because this is the thing, is that the way that a lot of people are about, like, 16-bit games, I am kind of about, like... sort of early 3D PS1-y kind of games.
Yeah.
Obviously, there are some that don't stand up well, but then there are, like, other ones, like Vagrant Story. And I do kind of like the... not so much Final Fantasy VII, but 8 and 9 look great to me still.
They do. They really do.
But yeah, so... Anything... Shall we continue with Square Enix?
Might as well. Like I mentioned, Final Fantasy XII, the Zodiac Age.
Yeah.
Finally, we're getting that next year. I'm so excited about that because I love Final Fantasy XII.
Yeah.
I love it a great deal.
It's my favorite one. But the problem is, I guess, that with the 10 and 10.2 HD, I bought on PS3, PS Vita, and PS4, and I haven't. I've barely played more than like a couple of hours.
I bought it on PS3, PS4, and I'm buying it for PC, and I still haven't played it.
Yeah. The problem, I don't know, I just feel more drawn to like replaying the original version. I mean, obviously, like, especially because in Europe, we got the version that we got of Final Fantasy X is the updated Japanese version.
So, yeah, we got international. We started with that version, so like, it's not as special for us. But I mean, still, I'm really happy to see 12 coming out, and because it deserves a second chance to get popular with people who didn't like it back in the day. Because a lot of people probably would like it even if they didn't like it back in the day. Because many just shrugged it off because it was different, and it was different. But it looks really cool.
Yeah.
And speaking of Final Fantasy, World of Final Fantasy
is
looking fucking great. It's coming out in October 28th, I think. And it's adorable. It's so cute.
Yeah.
And it's ATB combat. It's apparently like fucking... How long did it say it was? They said it was like 100 hours long or something.
Mm.
Like, completely ridiculous number they gave us. And it's like, okay. Because like, they just put so much content in from like almost every Final Fantasy game just for fun.
Yeah.
And that's cool. Like, I'm really excited about that.
Yeah, I watched the trailer and I liked the bit where Lightning was being very, very serious.
Yeah.
but like in chibi form.
Well, that's the thing. Like, all the recurring Final Fantasy characters are chibi characters, but they're completely in character and it's so good.
Yeah.
The other characters are not. Like, the other characters are normal characters, but they're called, like, giants because the other characters are chibi. It's so good.
Yeah. I think there's the two other games that from Square Enix I'm thinking of, but then it's probably best we wait until they come up in the other conferences.
No, we can talk about Kingdom Hearts.
Oh, well, Kingdom Hearts as well. I was thinking of Final Fantasy.
Well, I know one you were thinking of, definitely.
Oh, Final Fantasy 15 and Nier Automata.
Yeah. Nier, yeah. No, Kingdom Hearts 2.8, final chapter prologue. Looks good. It's Kingdom Hearts. I'm excited. The movie looks fun.
Yeah.
Whatever.
Yeah.
I'm going to play it.
Yeah, but especially because I was really pining after... After Birth by Sleep 2, as it was originally called. So I'm glad that we are getting... we are actually getting it before 3 comes out.
Oh, you mean a Questel story?
Yeah, a fragmentary
passage. Yeah, which is the first like taste of Kingdom Hearts 3, in a way. Because like, it's the first newly developed gameplay we're going to play for PS4.
Yeah.
So that's cool. I'm excited for that. I kind of hope to release 1.5 and 2.5 on PS4, because I kind of want them all on one system.
Yeah.
But I'm happy they're coming out. I like Kingdom Hearts a lot. I don't get people who complain about it, but whatever.
I don't have problems with the names either.
I mean, the thing is, like, yeah, they can be silly, but I will take fucking Dream Drop Distance over a game calling itself Prey again.
Yeah.
Or Doom again, or God of War again, we'll
or Revelations, or Chronicles,
oh, yeah, Returns,
yeah.
But that game's good. Star Ocean 5 looks fucking incredible. The English dub sounds really good, which is so odd, because Star Ocean 4's dub was so bad. Mm.
Well, haven't all the original, at least the original releases, always been bad, kind of?
Well, I mean, the thing is, like, I can't really remember the dubs for the ones before 4.
Because I heard that, like, the original version of 1 and 2, I don't know.
1 didn't have a dub. 1 was not released here originally.
Super Nintendo, right. The 2 on PS1, like, the dub is, like...
Well, yeah, it's a PS1 dub. Well, I think it wasn't like worse than other games in the system, which Star Ocean Last Hope absolutely was.
Mm.
Like, oh my god, the dub for Star Ocean Last Hope is one of the worst modern dubs in video games.
Yeah.
But the new one sounds really good, and they've had the voice actors on to like talk and stuff, and they had the last reveal of characters. I forget the character's name and the actress's name. But she's apparently a YouTuber who really likes Harry Potter.
Oh.
That's like, it was so odd. Like, they have this really, really like cheerful, energetic girl on. And I'm like, oh, who's this? I'm like, oh, she's a voice actress for this character. And she's like, she's talking about all this lore and stuff. And then she starts asking like the developer people and like the community people their questions instead of the other way around. And then like they go like, okay, so like, what do you do? And she's like, oh, well, you know. I'm on this Disney show, and she mentioned some Disney show called Bunked. Mm. And then she goes, but mainly, and I'm expecting some other show. She's like, but mainly I'm on YouTube,
yeah,
and I really like Harry Potter. I'm like, and I looked up her name, and the first thing I see is like a YouTube channel and literally like Harry Potter fangirl. And it's like,
yeah,
they just got some random YouTuber.
Yeah.
What?
I think.
She's really cool. She's really cool. She seems energetic, and like her performance is really good in the trailer, and the game looks really, really, really fun.
The problem is that in my mind, and I know that they're probably nothing alike at all, but in my mind, for some reason, Star Ocean 5 sort of merges in with Phantasy Star Nova. So,
well, they're both tries.
Well, yeah, they are. Are they good now?
I mean, I don't think Trias has ever been good or bad.
Mm.
I think they just kind of flip a coin every time they make a game.
Was Resonance of Fate Trias or Tricrescendo?
That's Trias.
Right.
That's the thing. Like, that's Trias. One of the best games from Last Generation is Trias. And yet they also made Infinite Undiscovery. Which, yes, you and I love
it. Yeah, we love it.
But
yeah.
It's not a good game. It's so bad. It's so fun.
Is it bad that the power supply for my my 360 broke recently, my initial reaction was, oh no, now I can't play Too Human and Infinite Undiscovery.
Oh my god. Too Human. Yes, that is bad. That is very bad. Mm. But no, Story of Fire looks really good. And Nier Automata.
Yeah.
Oh my god.
Yeah.
This game looks incredible.
It's amazing that the fifth game in a series is finally going to have good gameplay.
Yeah, explain the Nier and Drakengard thing for anyone who might not understand.
Oh, right. Drakengard was originally kind of like a Dynasty Warriors clone that was in very dark fantasy setting with a weird story. And none of the stories are none of the games are technically canon with one another, in a sense, because each of them require, like, say, for example, they made a manga to try and explain how 3 could be a prequel. No, it was an alternate universe version of Drakengard 1 that was canon with Drakengard 3. It's weird. It's weird. Nier is technically canon with one of the endings.
The joke ending.
The UFO kind of ending. Whatever it is in Silent Hill, whatever that last one is, the joke.
Yeah, the UFO ending. Yeah, in Drakengard 1, right?
Yeah, where you go through a portal and you fight... like a giant woman in the future, and then you get shot down by gunships or something.
Yeah, just random military gunships, because you ended up in our world, and that fucked things over, and that's where Nier is set.
Yeah. So this is set after one of the... Isn't this actually set after the... What is a UFO ending in Nier? Which doesn't exist in the game. It exists only like an audio drama thing.
It's really odd. Like, it takes place a bunch of years afterwards, and it's like humans don't live anymore or something, and now it's like androids live instead.
Yeah.
And it's really odd. But like, that's the thing though. It's it's directed by
Yoko Taro.
Yoko Taro, exactly, who is like the most...
He is a treasure.
He is the most adorable, strange man there is. Like...
Yeah.
When he was on Square Enix Presents, and he's sitting there with his giant fucking moon head.
Yes.
Just on as a mask. And not only does he do that, he starts complaining that his ear is itching.
Yeah.
And he can't scratch it.
And then he starts... like miming, like drinking his drink through the thing.
Yeah, he pretends to drink through his mask, and then he like starts grabbing onto like the, and I'm quoting, the young dashing developer from Platinum Games.
Yes.
what's his name? His name is Tarao, I think. Yeah, I think it's Tarao. His name is. And like he starts playing with his hair, like pulls on his hair and stuff until Tara like slaps him in the face. And it's like, this is an interview about a very like serious, downbeat, yeah, like depressing looking game. And they're sitting here just playing with each other.
Yeah.
But it was amazing. And like the game looks really interesting. I mean, it's obviously a low-budget production. It's not very pretty visually.
It seems to be higher budget than Drakengard 3, at least.
Yeah, oh yeah. But, like, it's like the setting is like this desolate wasteland called the City Ruins, and you play as this... I think the girl is called 2B, an android.
Yeah.
And they showed off a really cool boss fight, which was like all set to the music, the boss's pattern.
Mm.
So like it's this opera singing, like almost undead looking android, who is like dancing around the hall and like doing like bullet hell style things.
Yeah.
Like all the shooting enemies use bullet hell patterns.
Yeah.
With different and like in the game will like go top down now and then and like have different color bullets depending on if you have to jump over them or go underneath them.
Yeah.
And it's like, it's so cool. It looks like, even though the visuals aren't like a high production, it looks so pretty, like just in the way it all flows together. The animations are really good, actually. And like, and of course, even though Yokotaro has said that this game is going to have a happy ending, no one believes.
I thought he actually said that this could actually be the one where nobody survives.
Yeah, here's the thing. Yeah, he said that, but he also said, like, this game will have a happy ending. Which everyone was like, no, it won't. But then he says that, and then he moves on to saying that the key word for the game is futility.
Mm.
And it's like, but... it's, oh my god.
Right. See, the problem is, I was about to mention something that relates to the very last thing you do in the very last ending of Drakengard 3.
Okay, well, there's the spoiler warning.
Can I say that? But basically, something happens where you are meant to do an input, and you, without any kind of feedback for how to do that input.
Oh, wow.
Right, all right, then. Okay, because we put the spoiler warning there, I'll say.
Yeah, this is the last warning. Drakengard 3 spoiler is coming now.
They do the ending, or the ending that goes to Nier from Drakengard 1. They do that again. Yeah. It's a rhythm action thing. But this time it's set to music. It's set to a song that's like 7 or 8 minutes long, and so they start off and you see the inputs, and then as you get further, they move the camera in ways that means that you can't actually see where it's coming when it's coming, so you have to kind of rely on the sound. But then what happens is, at the very end, it slows down completely. And then the music fades out. And you hear the sound of the wave that's coming that you've got to repel.
Yeah.
But you can't hear the music anymore. You can just hear dialogue. So I then had to go on YouTube, listen to a version where someone had correctly pressed the button at the right moment, because otherwise I would have to go, because I tried this like 20 times, I think, and just like the thing of going through an 8 minute long, the same 8 minute long rhythm action segment like that many times, and like to fall at the last hurdle. It takes a special kind of playful trolling to do something like that. And
imagine Yokotaro designing something like PT or Resident Evil 7's demo.
Yeah,
just the amount of like illogical, ridiculous secrets would be in there.
Yeah, so that he did that for Drakengard 3. I shudder to think what he's going to do for Nier
Automata. Yeah, I'm really excited for Nier Automata, which he was going to call Nier Androids.
Yes.
But then he went to Square and he was like, we decided on the name, it's Nier Androids. And they said, like, that sounds terrible. So what they did was they Googled Androids and synonym until they found Automata. I was like, oh, okay, can we use this? And they're like, yeah, sure.
Yeah.
I love that game. I already love that game.
Yeah,
and that's out next year.
Yeah, and I like that in the process of making a sequel, that not like everything that a lot of us loved, because I bought that game day one. I bought that game when it was out in Europe and most US outlets hadn't reviewed it yet. Just because on the things that I'd read about it. And I was and it was one of those times when I feel vindicated. But yeah,
people love Nier. People really love Nier, and it was such a non-success that I did never expect like them to announce a new Nier at last E3, and then this year for like it to be one of the highlights of the show.
But yeah,
And they've kept like the odd face with like, oh, now we're side scrolling.
yeah, and now we're bullet hell.
Yeah.
But yeah, I'm really looking forward to that. So we on to Microsoft now.
Well, I guess we should do Final Fantasy 15. We can't really skip the biggest Square
Yeah, I
Enix
know,
title.
but it's comes up at both Microsoft and Sony, doesn't it?
Yeah, which is why I might as well do it
All
now.
right,
I
okay.
think it looks great. I think it looks great.
Yeah.
It looks really, really good. And it showed off the weight system finally,
The what
where basically.
is this the thing where you dive into and control someone else?
No,
Oh.
the weight system is basically just like in previous Final Fantasy games, you can go into the options and change the battle option from active to weight. And what that does is you play the game normally,
Yeah.
like you either put in an offensive action or a defensive action.
Yeah.
But if you stop inputting actions and you're not moving or attacking or defending, the game will pause.
Oh.
And you will have like a timer, and this timer slowly goes down. And now during this time you can like rotate the camera, you can decide a target, you have like a targeting system for enemies,
Oh, I
and they
like
can
that.
yeah, they can do the then you can get the actions again and keep fighting. And I think the timer like builds up over time the more you don't use it. So you can't just be paused forever,
Yeah.
but basically you can pause a very long time during a battle if you like need to stop and think. And honestly, I think that's a really good way to handle the fact that a lot of people will be going into this not being into like action RPGs.
Yeah.
And I think it's like, I mean, it's what I suggested they should have done, because that's basically what Final Fantasy XII did. And it looks really good. I think it. I mean, the UI could have some better work for it because it looked a bit awkward and it would just freeze and have like this big bar in the center. But they did say the UI is going through a final revision before release anyway, so
Yeah.
maybe that will be changed. But that was really cool, and I liked they showed off like the city you can go to and like take hunts like in Final Fantasy XII. You can go to a Colosseum and like bet on monsters that are fighting. The Colosseum only has monsters fighting,
Yeah.
and not humans. They wanted to make that clear. It's not like Final Fantasy XIII, so like in Returns where you can just go in and fight things. Like no, this is you bet on things. And it looked really nice. It looked really cool. It's pretty as hell, and it runs much better. They show off the Titan boss fight, and that was a really cool boss fight when it wasn't played at the Microsoft show.
Yeah.
Because they first showed it at the Microsoft show, and Matt, who was playing it, just completely fucked up. And they gave him his redemption moment later, as Granny's present, where they gave him a second chance to redeem himself
And
for
he
that.
didn't do amazingly from what I remember, didn't
No, he
he?
didn't. But like, I did like that they at least acknowledged that. Like, okay, you really fucked up on the Microsoft stage, so you know what? Let's give you a try again. Like that made me smile. But it looks good. It looks really fun. And like the new trailer was, both of the new trailers were really, really solid. But people were down like, oh man, they have a dubstep remix. But like, first of all, I'm not sure that was dubstep, but it was good. And it was really well edited, and all the action looked great. Like, come on, it looks awesome.
Yeah. So, and I didn't obviously because this is it's gonna have to probably gonna mention it at some point, but I didn't because I didn't watch it live and stuff. So, what exactly is the VR game? Or is
Okay,
it a
so yeah,
mode?
there's a VR thing for PlayStation VR where you like play as Prompto and it's like a rail shooter.
Oh, right.
And apparently it's not good.
Oh.
The people who played E3 did not say it was good. They also announced a new Final Fantasy 15 game
Oh, yeah.
called King's Tale Final Fantasy 15, which is going to be a game that's retailer exclusive.
Oh, God.
As a pre-order bonus, Final
Oh, fuck
15, and it's yeah,
that.
I was so pissed off because it looks great.
It does look
It's a
great.
fucking pixel art beat 'em up
And it's
game.
not even like, because that thing, something that you've mentioned before is how it's been, you've been annoyed with like the continued use of like those, like a specific kind of sprite in every Final Fantasy game, and like recently they've started diverging from that, and this is like another example of them doing like something different. And this,
retailer exclusive, and I'm like sitting here like, okay, so does it, will the Square Enix store be one of the retailers? Because I already pre-ordered my version from the Square Enix store.
I'm gonna look this up now. See if
They haven't announced the European retailers.
Oh, no. All right, okay.
That's what sucks extra about it. But, like, it's like, don't do that. Like, okay, if they say, like, oh, certain retailers will get you it for free, fine. I still think that's bullshit, but don't say it's retailer exclusive.
Mm.
Like, why can't they just buy that normally?
Yes.
But, yeah. But I guess we're moving on to...
Microsoft?
Well, actually, they showed off Mighty No. 9. It looks awful.
Mm. It's out now, isn't it?
I guess it is. I don't know. I don't care. Moving on to Microsoft.
Yeah.
Good show. A very good show. Microsoft showed off... They basically started off with saying, like, so, hey, by the way, all Xbox games now are going to be on PC as well. Like, basically, there's going to be this new thing called, like, Xbox... I forget what they're calling it, but basically every box that has a little logo on it means that this game, like this actual disc, will also work on Windows 10 PCs.
Mm.
And it's not just a Windows 10 compatible game, it's Windows 10 PCs, it's a PC version, because obviously otherwise it would work on tablets and stuff as well. Yeah. It's just like Gears of War 4, Scalebound, Dead Rising 4, like, pretty much every game... Oh, actually, every game they showed is working Windows 10 as well. So what I got at this conference was like, wow, Microsoft finally has a lot of games, and I don't need an Xbox to play them.
Mm.
Which was strange, because like, oh, Sea of Thieves, the MMO pirate game from Rare, looks fucking amazing, and I can play it on my Windows 10 PC.
Yeah.
Gears of War 4, a series I like a lot, looks better than ever, has a female playable character and lead. I can play it on my PC.
Mm.
Dead Rising 4 actually looks fucking hilarious.
Yeah.
And I can play it on my PC. It's like,
You can play 3 on PC, can't you?
Oh, yeah, you can now. You couldn't first.
Though. Or would you want to?
I mean, I hear it's good. Yeah. I haven't played it myself. I played it on Xbox. I played the demo. And I thought it was okay. Like, it was fine. I thought the colors were very... The colors sucked.
Yes.
Like, it was very desaturated, which made me sad. But, like, the gameplay was still just whack good old Dead Rising, which is good. And that seems to be the case of Dead Rising 4 as well, except you're Frank again, and you're taking pictures, and you can take selfies with zombies.
Yeah.
Which made me happy. Yeah. I like that. More selfie functions in games, please.
Mm.
But it sounds good. I like it. And it made me happy. Because, like, I'm probably going to get an Xbox One eventually.
Mm.
And now they announced a cheaper version of Xbox One, the Xbox One S.
Mm. That's not the one you're going to buy, is it?
No. Because they also announced the Project... I don't know. Something.
Scorpio.
Yeah, which is going to be the next Xbox One, but it's going to be fully compatible with all current Xbox One games, and all future Xbox One games will be compatible with both.
Did you notice that he seemed to be very strongly emphasizing that? Which I think means that they've heard that Sony aren't going to be doing that.
Well, actually, I don't think they've heard anything. I think they've heard people being like, what, I'm not going to fucking... get an Xbox One if I won't be able to like play games in the future.
Yeah.
Because I think the reason Sony isn't talking about the PS4 Neo yet is because they want to hear what Microsoft said first.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, like, they announced that stuff, which is fine. But like, I'm just glad, like, because it sounds to me almost like Microsoft says, like, okay, so yeah, we're gonna ride out the Xbox One and we're gonna compete with Sony's PS4 like we're doing, but fuck it, if the Xbox One is not gonna take off, we can at least put our games on PC and still make money.
The flip side to that is Quantum Break.
What about it?
That it doesn't run very well on PC.
So what? The game didn't look getting good anyway.
Well, I hear that it's actually kind of like, well, it's just kind of like Alan Wake. You know, it's like
without the Alan Wake story, which was Alan Wake's main feature.
Yeah. But you know, like the gameplay part of it is like, you know, classic.
Yeah, well, I expect Remedy. It to be. The thing though is like, I mean, that's to be a fair comparison though, because I mean, that's Remedy.
Well, yeah.
Like, and Remedy, I'll be honest, most of their PC games are good, but they have been hit and miss here and there. But like, I mean, I absolutely buy that, like, especially now that they're doing it as a standard thing, I'm going to assume that, you know, they're going to have better standards for it. Because they're actually, like, selling it as a big thing for Xbox games now.
Yeah.
Like, they're giving me a reason to go out and buy an Xbox One game. Like, I am going to buy Xbox One games now,
yeah.
Which is kind of funny. But that was neat. And I did enjoy seeing Dead Rising 4 there. I forget what else they showed.
Halo Wars 2?
Oh, yeah.
Creative Assembly?
Yeah, it's okay. So I'm not gonna be down on Halo Wars 2. It's probably a great game,
but you're gonna be down on the fact that they closed the developer. Yes. Of Age of Empires.
So, oh yeah, I'm not over this yet. So
it's fine,
the first Halo Wars was developed by the developers of Age of Empires, and because Halo Wars sold like fucking garbage, which it did, they closed that studio.
Oh, it was,
which is why Age of Empires 4 was cancelled and. You know, we never got another Age of Empires game. We never got a Count Online or any of the odd mobile games.
Do you know what the weird thing was? That they closed the developer, and then a lot of the people who worked there moved to another developer, and then they worked on the DLC for Halo Wars.
Yeah. That's the thing. So they closed the developer and made Halo Wars because Halo Wars was a disaster in sales. Mm. Then they make a sequel to Halo Wars.
The thing is,
if you have a chance, like, if Microsoft's sitting there with Creative Assembly in front of them and going, like, you're going to make an RTS, the next sentence should not be, make Halo Wars.
Yes.
It should be Age of Empires reboot.
The weird thing about Halo Wars, the first one, was that they used it to explain one of the most important concepts in the Halo universe. like lore-wise,
okay.
Which is, you know, the place where have you played the whole of the game, or did you just play the
I didn't play Halo Wars at all.
Right, it's basically the crux of Halo is ancient race called Forerunners create the Halo rings to, yeah. Like, as like, because the only way to kill the Flood is to starve them to death. So the idea is that you have to, like, destroy all life within a certain radius. And so it's, like, kind of like a doomsday weapon, it always looked like, in all of the previous Halo games. But then Wars, yeah, introduced shield worlds, which is, like, where people would go, where the Forerunners would all go to, like, shelter from these. So it actually made a bit more sense then.
Yeah.
But they chose Halo Wars as the place to explain this, yeah, it was a strange choice, but I remember liking it at the time.
I mean, like I said, it was probably a good game. It got good reviews from what I recall.
Yeah,
I just don't get why they wouldn't make a sequel to that and have Age of Empires, which everyone loves.
Yeah.
But, you know, okay, fine. I mean, it's also kind of odd since Halo 5 didn't sell, and now, like, Halo Wars 2, the sequel to the Halo game didn't sell, and it's like, really?
See, I am sort of a lapsed Halo fan, because in the lead-up to... sorry, this is going to sort of expose me as a teenager. Like, me, in the lead-up to Halo 2 coming out, I read The Fall of Reach, which was the prequel novel, which told everything from before the beginning of the Spartan Project all the way up to like 5 minutes before Halo 1 starts. And I, because it deals with like all these things with like space battles and all this kind of stuff. And so like, in that bit in the first level of Halo 2, when you actually get to see the Mac gun, which is like this massive thing, and then you're like walking along the outside in like low gravity, that kind of blew my 14-year-old's mind. So as someone who was very into the lore, I was thinking like that I might pick up an Xbox One like after Halo 6 was going to be coming out, but then they changed it from being a trilogy. So it's not, 6 isn't going to end the Reclaimer saga, as they're now calling it.
Wait, it isn't?
No. So, because the thing is, they're also, the Reclaimer saga is currently going to be more than 3 games, and it's also more than 2 trilogies of books as well.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, anyway, sorry.
Yeah.
Halo.
But no, so yeah, that's Halo Wars. I can't remember what else they showed. Like, it was a good, I remember it being a good presentation.
They showed
like,
and Gears 4.
Yeah,
which
was really good.
Which you liked.
It was Gears of War.
Yeah, I mean, I got
just Gears of War.
Got bored of Gears halfway through 2, so my interest in the series is kind of waned.
That's the good thing about me is I've had such a long break from Gears now that I'm like, man, I really want to play a Gears of War game. I was gonna get Ultimate for PC, but then I was like, oh no, I want to play 4. It has a girl in it.
Yeah,
and then like I was like, oh, I don't know if I get an Xbox One, and then they announced the PC product, and I'm like. Yeah. Yes, perfect.
But at the end, they did Forza Horizon 3, which is
that looks really good.
Yeah, I like Forza because it's kind.
Yeah.
It's kind of like GTA. It's GTA. It's like GT. It's like Gran Turismo.
Yeah, Gran Turismo.
But fun because
pretty much. I think Forza 2 is when like they is like, hey, guess what? We made a better Gran Turismo than you guys.
Yeah. But it was,
and I played a lot of Forza 2.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, Forza Horizon 3 looks good. I mean, it looks to be a bit like what I wanted the crew to be. And the crew is so shit. But like, it's this like open world, fun, just race around kind of thing.
Yeah.
Like, I'm down for that. Like, there was a reason I was hyped for Drive Club once upon a time. And then it took, like, a year, and then I didn't care anymore.
And, of course, that's another one of the ones that's going to be on PC.
Wait, Drive Club?
No, Forza Horizon 3.
Oh, yeah. Every Xbox game they announced is going to be on PC.
Mm.
Which is great. I'm hoping the controls are well. They are good, because one problem I had with the first Forza Horizon, which was the last Forza I played, was I did not like the controls. I didn't like how the cars handled, but we'll see.
Yeah.
See, they announced that General Rom from Gears of War is coming to Killer Instinct, because Killer Instinct is now Super Smash Bros. For Microsoft.
Yeah.
And I'm okay with that.
Mm.
That's actually probably a very fitting thing for them.
Yeah.
So, you know what? Cool. Why not? We'll see what we get next. Maybe that guy from Scalebound.
Oh, God.
So let's talk about Scalebound.
Right, go on, yeah.
I thought Scalebound looked okay. I do not understand why people say it looks great. Do you understand why people say it looks great?
I don't know. Well, I think as a sort of like a fan of like Platinum's games,
yeah.
I didn't really fully watch this, so I've only seen bits and pieces. I still find the protagonist the fact that don't they all that way? Like if you play on multiplayer, they all are all the same.
They all look like DMC Dante.
Yeah, and that still confuses me. Why that's a thing, people like it.
Yeah, like they were like, oh man, this is the biggest boss fight that Platinum Games has ever made.
It's not.
Really?
It won't be.
I thought the Bayonetta final boss was bigger.
Yeah, and also the Wonderful 101 was bigger than that. So,
yeah, I mean, this was kind of the size of, like, the Metal Gear fight in Metal Gear Rising.
Yeah.
But okay, fine. And, like, it's multiplayer, fine. But, man, it just looks so kind of, eh. It looks okay.
Mm. But I'm glad, at least, that Platinum seemed to be... Because it's an open-world RPG, right?
I think so, yeah.
So it's
it's Nier Automata.
Like, yeah, so I'm glad that...
It's also Platinum.
So I'm glad, at least, that Platinum are more diversifying now. Because because obviously, you know, with Clover, we had, like, you know, we had Akami. We haven't had... the closest thing we've had to something that wasn't, like, action-y has been Infinite Space.
Yeah. Infinite Space was definitely the least Platinum games or Platinum games as games.
Yeah.
Followed by Vanquish, I guess?
Probably Star Fox.
Oh, yeah, that was Platinum games.
Yeah.
I forgot. Oh, yeah, by the way, Nier Automata is from the developer I talked about before, who is the lead designer, whose name is already Tarao, I think it was.
Yeah.
He was the lead designer, or he was part of the lead design on Anarchy Reigns and Metal Gear Rising. So,
oh, I like both of them.
Yeah, so Nier Automata is going to be fucking lit.
Yeah.
Like, oh my god. Yeah, I think that sums up the Microsoft press conference. I can't think of anything we've missed.
Oh, John Carmack?
Oh, yeah, Minecraft. Okay, so Minecraft and John Carmack was there. And he was like, hi, I'm John Carmack. I'm playing with the Oculus Rift in Minecraft, and it's really cool. I can see this world you've created.
Yeah.
I don't have a punch like this. I just like pretending to be John Carmack because he's much cooler than me.
Yeah.
And that was the thing. Like, I was kind of happy to see John Carmack there.
Aren't they doing, like, cross-platform servers now or something?
They are, yeah. So you can play with between platforms. Not all platforms, at least not yet, but they're working on, like, bringing out cross-platform things for everything.
The problem I have is that, for me, a big part of what Minecraft is about is having, like, a big world that you'll never reach the end of, and you can just keep walking.
Yeah.
And so, like, on PC, the world generation size is, like, 8 times the size of the
I think the PC version is still, like, considered its own.
Yeah, but
like, this is the so-called pocket editions and the console editions will start merging up.
This is the problem I have, is that the laptop I use is, like, barely more powerful than a 360. So why does the PS4 version have, like, a world that's only, like, 500 blocks across?
I don't know. I'm guessing it has to do with cache memory or something.
Possibly. I don't
know. And that's coming out to Wii U now as well.
It's Minecraft. It's out.
Oh, is it? Okay. I just know that the box that has a girl on it, which made me confused.
Yeah, and the Mario DLCs are also out.
I can't believe it. It's so odd. I wish it had a Microsoft logo on the box art, but it doesn't.
Also, the Telltale game had a second season pass. Is also still a thing that I find strange, because it was...
Well, they announced a Minecraft battle mode.
Mm.
I don't even know what that is.
It's because people made Hunger Games mods.
Yeah.
And so people are making, like... So they decided to make, like, an official battle arena kind of thing going on.
Oh, cool. Well, that's nice.
Yeah, I think because of the Mario stuff, I might... But even though I'm not a big Mario fan, I might get that version just because it is something different from the other console versions.
I just think it's cute that Minecraft's still a thing. I mean, I like Minecraft.
Yeah.
People have started shitting on it lately, but, like, I like it.
Yeah, part of the thing is, yeah. I want to LP it, but the problem is everyone's LP'd it.
Yeah, that's the thing. Like,
want to be one of those people?
Yeah, I love Let's Plays, but I have never been able to enjoy a Minecraft Let's Play, and I don't think I could ever make one myself.
So part of me thinks that I should do one, but then label it as something completely different, like some game, like, I don't know, like Time Shift or something.
Time Shift.
Yeah. Or legendary, or whatever.
Clearly, Heroes of Victory is where we're going with this. The most popular World War II shooter.
Oh, Hour of Victory.
Oh yeah, that was it. I couldn't even remember the name. Oh my god, that game was so bad.
Yeah.
I love thinking of terrible shooters on the 360.
What was the Man in the High Castle one? Turning Point.
Turning Point, Fall of Liberty. Yes. Yeah. I love that one. That game, like, I was so hyped for Turning Point, Fall of Liberty. Like, actual, legit hyped. Because they were like, oh, it's a World War II game where we've changed the narrative so the US gets invaded by a surprise invasion. And you have to, like, instead of a soldier, you play a civilian rising up. I'm like, oh, man, that sounds really cool.
Yeah.
And, like, it finally released, and I picked it up, and I couldn't play past, like, the first 10 minutes because it's so poorly coded. Like, the AI of the enemies are the kind of enemies that would be, like, as soon as they, like, they pass a corner, they would be, like, headshot.
Mm.
And it's, like, it's so bad.
Yeah.
It's so bad. But, yeah, yeah, I think that sums up Minecraft.
Yes.
Like, Microsoft, not Minecraft.
Yeah.
Microsoft. The important thing is that John Carmack was there.
Yes.
Which, please, Microsoft, bring on John Carmack for all your press conferences from here on, because that will make me like you more.
Yeah.
So, Sony conference, which I think is agreed the biggest conference of the E3 this year again.
Yeah, it seemed to be the one that a lot of people.
Sony has been stealing it lately. Like, oh my god.
Mm.
So they opened with God of War, the reboot, which is now an open world RPG.
Yeah.
Still using, like, character action combat.
I mean,
but it's like open world RPG, and Kratos is a father in Norse mythology.
The thing is, it's like, why would I care about that when Horizon Zero Dawn exists?
Yeah, but the thing is, like, I was watching it, I'm like, this looks really fun. I would like to play this. Why is this God of War?
Yeah. Right, so.
And it's just called God of War, and it's like, you couldn't even call it Dad of War?
Yeah.
Really?
So
the pun was obvious.
So the, what ones have you played?
I've got a War. Yeah. I played God of War 2. I don't know if I played the first one or not. I played 1 and 2, I think.
2 was the best one.
I played God of War 2. I played God of War Ascension.
Oh, right.
What's it called? Ascension?
Yeah,
Awakening?
Ascension, yeah. Ascension.
But
at the end of 3, because they were trying to find ways to make it continue as a series after the end of 3.
Yeah.
There's a line near the end where Zeus turns to Gaia and says, "Maybe you should have chosen the other one." To try and
find. Oh yeah, I've heard that.
They were gonna, like, bring some other character in. So I'm at least glad that they didn't go that kind of direction, like saying there was someone else. It's interesting. What I think is interesting is not God of War 3 so much as the two God of War 3 games we didn't get. So, have you heard of what David Jaffe would have had?
No. Please tell.
All right. So David Jaffe's idea for, because this is the interesting thing, is that every game in that series has had a different director. So David Jaffe, who did the first one, his idea would have been to have Kratos killing everyone in every other mythology. So just, like, piling them up. And then there was Stig Asmussen. Is that the right word? No, Corey Barlog. Stig Asmussen was the guy who did 3. Corey Barlog did 2, and his idea was going to be a first-person shooter.
Oh my god, they should have done that.
They kept one thing of it, actually. The very last thing you do at the end of God of War 3 is you don't move, but you just press the buttons, and it does, like, combos from a first-person perspective. I find those two games we never got more interesting to think about, like pretty interesting to think, like imagine a God of War 3 that was a first-person shooter somehow. I think it would have actually been all right.
Yeah, and the new one looks like Skyrim. Like, even the UI is Skyrim.
Yeah.
It's just... And I like Skyrim, so I'm like, okay, I'm cool with that. And it might be good. I mean, I'm down for a good little RPG, but it just feels like such an odd way to present God of War.
Yeah.
But then you mentioned Horizon Zero Dawn, which basically looks like Zelda.
Well, it looks like the Zelda we haven't talked about yet.
Yeah, exactly. it looks like Breath of the Wild. It looks really cool. It's like,
The dialogue.
You run around with a bow and arrow and you attack monsters and their machines.
It looks great. I'm definitely going to enjoy playing it. I think I might be listening to podcasts while I play it because I don't like the dialogue. It sounds weird. I don't know if it's just because it feels like it's faked for like a trailer purpose, but I don't think it is. I think it's just like
the trailer dialogue was really bad. I agree with that.
Because I don't know if it's like it could be either that it is like that or if it's just like a heavily tutorialized game. And I am very, especially in recent years, I'm very sensitive to the overuse of tutorials in games. Like, I think I showed you that screenshot a while back. Probably the most egregious one was the most recent Fatal Frame Project Zero game, where it, like, you're about to get hit by one of you. I think it makes you stand still, and then you're about to get hit by one of the ghosts, and then it freezes time and says, you should not get hit by ghosts if you don't want to get attacked, or something really, really painfully obvious to anyone who has understood like the basic concept of games
The Price Zero 5 was kind of, people didn't really like that one, did they?
I have found it difficult to get into. It's definitely not as
I don't really heard anything good about it, and I really like 4. I really like 4, but I don't know.
I think it has interesting ideas, and I like the way that it uses the tech from Dead or Alive 5 of water and stuff. Because the idea is that it's meant to be set in a suicide forest.
Okay,
and so there's like, I think it's like the water there is corrupted and no one can, like, the souls of no one can rest, and it feels like if it had the budget it deserved, it would have been really good.
If Nintendo hadn't bought the license.
Well, no. if Nintendo had given it the budget that it deserved.
Oh, right, yeah, because it's a Wii U game, isn't
it?
For some reason I was thinking it was on Wii, and I was like, no. You're right.
Yeah, it had like a smaller budget than the Wii games.
Oh my. Yeah, that's odd.
But
yeah, PS conference. So Horizon Zero Dawn looks really good.
At least
there were more things announced. Oh yeah, of course, finally, Crash Bandicoot is coming back.
Why?
Because people have been fucking nagging Sony and Activision about it for years. And now, like, they announced it, and, like, you have... they're going to make complete, like, HD remasters of the original trilogy. And Crash is coming to Skylanders alongside his old buddy Spyro.
Did you...
Which means he's finally going to be in a good game.
Did you... Oh, wait. But basically,
I said it.
I was about to ask you. Were any of them ever good?
I don't like Crash. I don't get the Crash games, but I'm glad fans are getting what they want. I like Skylanders though, so like that's cool.
I know people like CTR.
Oh, yeah, Crash Team Racing, yeah.
But no, I don't think I've ever liked... even on the PS1, it's not like you couldn't play Spyro instead. You know?
Yeah, that was the thing. Like, that's exactly the thing. Like, it was like, oh, why would I play Crash Bandicoot? I have Spyro the Dragon.
Yeah.
But you know, like that's cool, I guess. Again, I am glad I felt getting with
because
it there.
To me, the only good game that Naughty Dog have ever made was the first Jack and Daxter. And I've
not, the one without the guns.
Yeah, the one without the guns. I like that one, and I don't like any. I don't like any of the Crash Bandicoot games. Maybe Crash Team Racing. It's been a while since I played it. I loved it at the time, but then I tried to get back into it and it didn't work. I don't like Uncharted, and I don't like The Last of Us.
I like Uncharted 2. I haven't played Uncharted 4 yet. Let's see, what else did you show?
Sorry, can I just quickly say, the thing that sort of like summarizes my opinion of Naughty Dog is that there is a lighting glitch towards the end of Uncharted 1, and in The Last of Us, they still hadn't fixed it. But yeah, go on, sorry.
Resident Evil 7.
Oh, yeah.
So
you've played it.
I've played it for over 20 hours, my friend.
Hi.
I'll get to it. So Resident Evil 7 is a first-person horror game. It's a ghost story set in probably Louisiana. We don't know for certain yet. And it's actually looking really promising. So basically, as the director, I forget his name now, Kawata something. I want to say Masashiro Kawata, but I might be wrong there. After Resident Evil 6, the team basically like looked at the feedback and basically agreed that the biggest issue they had from a development standpoint was that they were trying to please everybody and in the end just didn't please anyone.
Mm.
So what they decided to do instead was basically start splitting up the series. So
you have
Umbrella Corps, which is just going to be action.
Yeah.
You have Revelations, which is going to be like the mix.
Mm.
And the main game is going to go back to Resident Evil 1. Specifically Resident Evil 1. That's what they've gone back to and looked at what made this game scary. And I can see it. The game has a very Resident Evil 1 feel. It's first person. It's people are comparing it to PT, which I feel is disingenuous. Because PT wasn't unique enough to actually establish what a first-person horror game is. It's just a first-person horror game.
From first glance, the look of it and the way that they're promoting it is similar to PT.
And I
I've not played it. It's the only thing I've got to compare it.
Yeah, and there I will agree. Because the first thing I said, actually, the first thing I said was, "Oh, is this Condemned?" Because they did the mannequin thing. But then I was like, "Oh, it's PT," because they did the cockroach thing.
So at least, if nothing else, it's better than PT.
But here's the thing, like, and it's doing the PT thing where, like, they release a demo on the PSN, and it has a bunch of secrets in it, which we're trying to solve. But here's the thing. So, the demo itself, I finished it in 25 minutes, I think.
Yeah.
And I took a lot of extra time in there. And I wasn't scared by it. I didn't find it particularly scary. Other people have. I should point that out. People are saying it's very scary. So it's just that, I guess it's just not my kind of scary. Because I'm not going to sit here and say that I'm so desensitized to scary things. Because no, I'm a scaredy cat in the right situations. Mm. But it's not my type of horror to be scared.
Yeah.
But like, I didn't dislike it. I do like that it's a focus on inventory management and puzzles. And the big puzzle in the demo is there's a videotape. And the videotape is taking place before the main game, but it's in the same house. Yeah. But you're playing the videotape as the cameraman and not just watching it. And things you affect in the tape might have an effect on present day. I know it makes no logical sense, but that's the main mechanic of the game. Right. So, like, if you cause something, I'm not going to spoil anything, but if you cause something in the videotape, that might affect the present day and give you a new way to progress. And that's really interesting. And I did really like that mechanic, actually. It's really fun to play around with. We've currently hit a dead end, and a bunch of people have sort of given up hope that there is more to find in the demo, but Capcom has not said that we've found everything or to stop looking yet, so some of us, myself included, are still playing this demo over and over again to try and find more hidden secrets. And it's funny, because during these video sessions, there are 7 appearances of a ghost that you might get. There's no clear decided way to on what the size on how the game decides if you see them or not, but there are 7 total appearances where places where the ghost can appear. Most people get it on the first or second try, they get 1 or 2 ghosts. Almost everyone gets a ghost once or twice, here and there. I've played this game for 20 hours. 0 ghosts. I've been sitting with Slow Beef from Red Spray. We've been playing and talking.
Yeah.
I've been matching side-by-side footage of me playing with Slow Beef playing. He will get ghosts, I will not get ghosts. I do not understand why my game is not haunted. That is the scariest thing with Resident Evil 7 so far, is that my game is not haunted. But, yeah. But it's really interesting. It's fun to toy around with, and I do think it's definitely the right direction for the series to take. I am very hyped for it, and this is coming from someone who, after Resident Evil 6, I sold my Resident Evil collection because I was like, fuck this, I don't even want to be associated with this anymore.
I mean, well, you had a lot of copies of Resident Evil 6, didn't you, from what I remember?
Well, yes and no. So Resident Evil 6, basically, I bought the collector's edition, which was $250, I think. Yeah. And because I wanted the steelbook with the slipcase, I had ordered a second copy from Amazon. So another $50 on top of that. So that was about $300. Now, I sold both of those copies.
Yeah.
So I don't have those anymore. And the only money I've given Capcom since for Resident Evil game was when I was buying Resident Evil 6. Yes, Resident Evil 6 again for PC for a charity event.
Right.
Specifically because it was a charity event. Now, because of what happened during the event, Resident Evil 6 was the one game we didn't end up playing, so I wasted my money. But otherwise, I've been on the not buying anything more Resident Evil related side of things. But with 7, I'm interested again. And the fact that it's going to be canon to the other games, but it's also going to be a fresh start in that, like, yeah, this is happening in the same timeline as the rest of the games, but it's also a complete, like, it won't have a direct connection to, like, specific events you know of.
Right, so I've not played 6.
Good.
Well,
do you really want to see Ada Wong's nipples?
Well, the thing was that it's just that
because those are in there.
I heard there was the it's just because it's been released on PS4 recently, and so if it goes on sale, I might get it.
Well, just get 5 instead.
I don't like
5 and 4 are coming out on PS4.
But then again, I don't like 5.
The thing is, like, 5 is fun to play in co-op.
Yeah, but see, I didn't play in co-op. So it was the game where I repeatedly pressed B to keep Sheva from getting killed by a guy with a chainsaw.
Well, you won't have that problem in 6, but you won't have fun either, because, like, the single player is terrible.
Yeah, I didn't even like the demo. But part of me does want to play it as, like, a sort of artifact of its time. But anyways, sorry, I'm getting sidetracked. I was under the impression that the end of 6 is basically just, like, a global apocalypse.
Well, no, the start of 6 is a global apocalypse.
So, is 7 set after everything's been rebuilt?
Yeah, see, that's the problem with the Resident Evil canon, right?
Yeah.
Is that they kept going bigger and bigger to the point where they were like, oh shit, the entire world's infected.
And now it's just in the house.
But then it's like Revelations 2 happens.
Hmm.
And the world isn't infected.
No.
And it's like, but I thought, like, oh, well, I guess it was just, like, most of the world. Oh, but didn't we say all of America was, like, completely... No, well, I guess not. Oh. Okay. Well, fine then.
Yeah.
It's quite clear that they didn't want to reboot Resident Evil, which was my suggestion. That's what I said it should have done. But they also didn't want to, like, have to think about all the things they did.
Yeah.
If they kept referring to, like, how characters like Chris became more of a superhero than a believable horror protagonist.
Mm.
And it's like, yeah, no shit.
Mm.
And then, like, that's why, like, there won't be a returning playable character. Instead, it's going to be a new character. Thank fuck. First time since fucking Resident Evil 2.
Mm.
Not counting 0. but Rebecca was technically a returning character.
Yeah.
And Billy and Sheva were side characters, and so was Helena. So, you know what I mean. But I'm excited for it. I think it's a very good direction to take, and I mean, it's kept me interested. So, that's good.
As someone who kind of like drifted out when it got more action based, I'm still not sure whether I prefer first person to that. I still don't know. I need.
The switch to first person is probably going to be what bugs people the most, and I will understand that.
Mm.
And I think it'll be fine, to be honest. Because they've said, like, for example, combat is going to be minimal. There's going to be combat.
See, to me, the combat is part of it. Like in terms of, like, I like the combat in the top-down ones. You know, the pre-rendered ones and the CVX.
Yeah. And they likened this to the first one, where, like, yeah, there's combat, but, like, there won't be swarms of zombies or a bunch of enemies at once. It'll be, like, maybe one or two enemies, and, like, that's how they're doing it. And I really do like that. I think it's the right approach. But, I mean, we're going to have to see more of it first. Yes. It's coming out in January, though.
Yeah. Like,
it's much earlier than I thought.
I hope we'll be seeing more of it at, like proper gameplay of the actual game and not, you know, more of the demo.
Yeah, the trailer is half demo, half fan game.
Mm.
Which is interesting. Because the demo is a prequel. It's not the part of the main game. It's a separate prequel.
Is it... Right, so is it prequel in the sense that it won't be in the game, or it won't be, like, the proper game? It will be, like, a prologue chapter in the game?
No, you will not play anything of the demo in the final game.
Wouldn't it make more sense to say prologue chapter than the beginning hour or whatever it was?
We have no idea why it's called beginning hour, because it takes does not take an hour to play. But no, because there's been some confusion about this. People saying, like, oh, the demo isn't related to the final game. It is. You won't be playing the same character, you won't be playing these events.
Yeah.
But the demo is the beginning of what's going to happen in the final game. It's what sets up the final game. But yeah, that's Resident Evil 7. I'm excited for it. Hideo Kojima came out on a big fucking lit up stage revealing him as an announcement.
Yeah.
As he walked forward across, like, Billie Jean style fucking just light up grids. It's ridiculous. Yeah. And then he's like, here's Norman Reedus naked.
Yeah.
And that was the entire announcement.
Yeah.
Death Stranding. It's an action game, maybe.
Yeah, I'm trying to find...
That's all we know.
The website for the game, from what I remember, seems to be... Like, it might be a metatextual-type game about making games.
But here's the thing. They've already said that all they've made so far was a teaser.
Yes.
So it's like, they haven't even started working on it yet.
Mm.
But my favorite thing, though, is that if you look at the logo for Death Stranding,
yeah,
and you remove all the letters that don't have dripping lines of, like, something tar or whatever it is,
yeah,
from them, and remove the ones that haven't,
yeah,
it doesn't say Death Stranding. It says Eat Standing.
Yes.
And PlayStation... The official PlayStation Twitter account retweeted an image of Eat Standing and Norman Reedus eating standing up naked.
Yeah.
And that made me so happy.
I quite like the other edit, which was Shower With Your Dad Simulator.
Oh, that's good. Oh, that's good. But no, I'm looking forward to hearing more about
it. Yeah, I want
to
know. I'm glad.
That's the thing, we don't know anything about
it. I am glad that Kojima is working on something that isn't Metal Gear.
Yeah.
You know, because there's, like, all sorts of games that I didn't know existed at the time, and I wish I did, like Boktai.
Boktai was great.
Mm.
It was so inconvenient, yes, for someone who's not an outdoor player as myself.
Yeah, especially since it was on the GBA, wasn't it?
Yeah, with the GBA, it had a solar sensor. Yeah, you used the light of the actions, just like vampires.
And the original GBA model was known for having a very reflective screen. Inconvenient for any kind of like playing it.
And the GBA SP had a card slot beneath.
Yes.
So it was like, oh fuck, now I gotta find sun to come down from behind my face somehow.
Yeah.
It was so dumb. But yeah, I'm glad to see Kojima working on something that is a Metal Gear. I'm kind of glad Metal Gear is dead.
Mm.
I kind of wish it had died a while ago instead.
Oh,
you know, when it had a proper ending to die on.
Shall we do spoilers for this? Do you know what happened?
You found something?
Yeah.
I think I do. I haven't played it through yet, so let's not do it just in case. But I think I've heard all the spoilers.
Right. You do know that it kind of doesn't fulfill the roles that game should have. Story wise,
because the actual third of the game wasn't developed.
What some people say is like the mission after the one that is the last one in the game is the end, and I don't agree with them, because the thing that I noticed was that you know, all of the songs in the game are from like the time period, apart from one, which is in the 90s.
Oh, that would have been interesting.
Friday I'm in Love by The Cure is in the 90s, which makes me think there was going to be even if it was only one more mission after that, it was going to deal with bridging the gap with what happens between a certain character who we know, from trailers who he was.
Oh my god, that would have been really interesting, actually.
And how he became, you know.
Yeah.
In, you know, the Metal Gear Solid 1. And that would have sort of like neatly connected things together, perhaps. That's my theory.
Holy shit, Konami, you play us like a fiddle.
Yeah. there's that. But then there's. I'll say it with the way that I can do without being spoilery. The very last cutscene of The Phantom Pain tries to make this sort of thing be like, oh, and perhaps the real hero was you all along for playing the game.
Perhaps the real Metal Gears were the friends we made along the way.
Yep. And the fact that it came at the exact point when I was realizing, because I played through it quite quickly, so it wasn't actually widely known at that time that this was a problem.
Yeah.
So I was just kind of like, so they're not actually, you're just going to say nice things about me and you're not going to actually complete the bloody series like you're supposed to.
That's brilliant. I need to play through it now.
Yes,
and
also there is another thing that I'm not going to say specifically. They completely retcon something from a game that happened earlier in the series.
Yeah.
In a way that is completely stupid, and I don't know why they did it entirely, but I'm curious to what you think of that as well.
Oh, we'll get there.
Yes.
I am gonna sit down and play it eventually. I do own it. I'm looking at my copy right now.
Have you? Because I remember you did Ground Zeroes. Have you started Phantom Pain?
No, that's the thing. I did Ground Zeroes, and I disliked it so much that I was like, I'm not gonna play Phantom Pain right now.
Yeah.
I did not like Ground Zeroes a bit. I didn't even care for the gameplay. People were like, oh man, the gameplay is so good. And like, it's Metal Gear finally pretending that it's caught up to other stealth games. Play other stealth games.
Well, I liked it. How it played, at least. The problem with Phantom Pain is...
It played fine. It was just nothing special at all.
Mm.
But yeah, so Death Stranding was announced, whatever that is.
Yeah.
What else did they announce? They had a lot of things. Oh yeah, Detroit.
Yeah.
Detroit was there. David Cage's new game, and it's a David Cage game. They're promising that all the decisions you make are going to have all the consequences, which means there will be three or four that matter.
Yeah.
It's a David Cage game.
I still haven't picked up Beyond. I really want to.
I mean, it's gonna be free on PS Plus eventually, so.
Probably.
That's a thing. Why? Like, I know it's gonna be. So, like, even if I wanted to play the PS4 version just for gags, it would be like, oh, it's gonna be free eventually.
Yeah, because I had a lot of unintended fun from Heavy Rain, especially.
Heavy Rain is so terrible, but so funny.
Yeah, because when you take it seriously, the fact that a lot of the time when you're supposedly in a near-death situation, you can just put the controller down and nothing happens.
Well, that was the thing for me. Like, when I realized that the first time in Heavy Rain, I was trying to take it seriously. And you know, when it's kind of early in the game, but when you, I think it's the second challenge, something that, is it Ethan, his name is? He has to drive a car on the wrong side of the
Yes, and
road.
then you can
He
just,
crashes
it's
and
like,
it's upside
oh, it's like,
down.
oh, the gasoline's leaking out and you're gonna
Yeah, it's
die.
gonna
And you just
explode.
put the
And I was
controller
like,
down and you can leave it and he's completely
yeah, that
fine.
was exactly where I was. 'Cause I was like, you know what? I don't care about Ethan. And I put the controller down. I went to the store. I ordered pizza.
The thing that
And like half an hour later, I return home and nothing has happened. I eat the pizza.
I love the idea that, like, in concept, that a character could die and the story could continue, but then I
Yeah,
went
but
through playing deliberately trying to kill everyone, and it's only like in the final third of the game that
in
I
the
can
final
actually.
third of the game, there's like two or three characters that might die.
Yes.
If you if you and the best part is when you if it's what's her name?
Yeah, I know what you mean.
What's her name? Well, the reporter.
Yes.
Like this one moment where like you have when the when she's in the burning building. And like the one time she can die in
Oh,
there
yeah.
is when you open the door, the window, and she says, "I will die if I jump," and you can choose jump, and she will die. And it's like, wow, really?
Oh, and the way that she actually escapes is by hiding in the fridge. I
Yes,
still,
genius.
still, yeah.
And yeah, the apartment explodes, but the fridge was fine. And they don't even show her surviving the explosion, like getting out. You just cut to her exiting the building, getting on her bike, and driving away.
I think my favorite one is my favorite one of the endings is when Ethan gets captured by the police.
I like when he gets shot because he dared to, like. Like he has like a wound on the side and he's like, oh shit, and they think he's pulling a gun and like 50 cops just shoot him and it's like he clearly had no gun.
For the I think the most like sort of depressing of his endings was the one where he gets captured by the police and then he's in his cell and then he just like silently makes a noose.
Oh
Yeah.
yeah.
Oh, David Cage, I'm just remembering about that bit where you had to when you played that the FBI agent and you have to do someone's tie. Why?
Oh yeah.
Why?
Oh, it's really good actually. If you haven't yet, go to Slow Beef's channel after listening to this
Oh
and
yeah,
look at all
I've
the videos
seen.
called like Heavy Juice, Heavy
Yeah.
Tie, everything called Heavy something. Look this up. It's Slow Beef's wife, Shitty Cat, and she's playing Heavy
Yeah.
Rain for the first time and it's hilarious.
Yeah.
I think the Juice one is my favorite.
Because I know a lot of people say that that Uncharted is a good game for playing when you've got someone with you who doesn't play games. Like and maybe has like movies as a better frame of reference because
Yeah.
they can like have fun in that. But I find that things like Heavy Rain are probably better for people who have less experience with games,
Well, Heavy Rain, if it was
like to
quick.
actually play. Yeah.
Like take fucking Life is Strange instead.
Yes, but play Life is
Go
Strange.
play Life is Strange instead. It's so much
But
better.
that's just some general life advice.
Yeah. That's a very good life advice. I don't know, what else did they show at Sony's conference? I felt like they showed a lot
Wait,
more, but I can't remember it.
just quickly. So Detroit is kind of based on
the car tech demo. Yeah.
So what are they going to do for that thing that was kind of like a fantasy setting thing?
They're not going to do it, I guess.
I think they will. I think that's the next game.
Ah, maybe. Oh, do you mean The Wizard?
The Wizard, yeah.
Yeah, that was like a short film they made. It's an extended version from that E3. Mm. But I don't know. But yeah, the old man face returned in The Wizard.
Yeah.
The old man face returned. That was great. Fuck, I feel like I'm forgetting some big announcement. The hell was it?
All right. Well, just because while you're thinking, Bend Studio, who is a team who I thought had closed, and I actually kind of respect them. They've actually got a console game now, because for the last few years they've been making primarily handheld games. They made the really good Resistance Retribution.
For PSP.
Yeah, for PSP. Yeah. And the PSP Siphon Filter games, most recently. But yeah, interesting to see them being able to work on a PS4 game now.
Okay, so Last Guardian. I can't believe I forgot about Last Guardian. Has a release date.
Yeah, it's got a release date.
Yeah, people finally get to play it.
Yeah.
Spider-Man.
Yeah. So, I didn't see this. What is this? Like,
Spider-Man? Okay, so basically, Spider-Man, the way they announced it was they had the guy from Sucker Punch Games come out.
Insomniac?
It was like...
It's Insomniac, isn't it?
I don't know why I said Sucker Punch Games.
Well, they made a comic book-esque superhero type game.
Insomniac can come out. And I was thinking, yes, I'm going to get to cross off my Resistance box. But no,
Resistance is dead.
Yeah, apparently. But, and then, like, we have a superhero from Queens, and then Spider-Man video, and it looks pretty good. I'm excited for a new Spider-Man game. I was kind of hoping they could have done Spider-Gwen or Miles Morales instead, you know, but, well, you know, I'll take it. Days Gone, the new zombie survival game.
Yeah, that was the Bend Studio game, yeah.
Yeah, and it's like... From the developers of Bubsy 3D, here's a zombie survival game.
Are we getting mixed up? What was the... Days... Because as far as I remember, Days Gone was the Studio Bend one.
Yeah, wasn't that who made Bubsy 3D as well?
No. Bubsy 3D was made by Arc...
Yeah, Bend Studio made Bubsy 3D. I'm looking at it right now.
Oh.
Bend Studio made Bubsy 3D. Yeah, don't get my guy. I have my facts straight. So from the developers of Bubsy 3D, here's Days Gone. But no, it looks okay. It looked like an average shooter.
Oh, I think I was getting confused because I thought people meant the joke Bubsy game.
No, the real Bubsy 3D.
Because
from 94 or whatever.
Oh right, okay.
86.
Yeah, it is, yeah. Bubsy 3D, then Siphon Filter.
Yeah. Farpoint, which is like a sci-fi shooter. There's a lot of sci-fi shooters.
I didn't see that.
It's a VR, like on Mars, and you shoot things.
Oh, right.
And the big sci-fi shooter.
Oh, yeah.
It started off as a ship assault in space.
Yeah.
Infinite. And everyone was like, oh my god, this looks amazing. It looks like the Battlefront we always wanted. What game is this? And then they were told it was Call of Duty, and now they hate it.
Yeah, and now they downvoted it. So,
yeah. Seriously, Call of Duty Infinite Warfare looks fucking incredible. I want it badly. I can't believe I'm saying that, but like it looks like one of the most original shooters in a while.
Yeah.
Batman Arkham VR.
I didn't.
Which apparently was really good. I heard. I don't know.
So is this a different thing from the Telltale one?
Yeah, this is not the Telltale one.
This is the Rocksteady one.
I don't know. Yeah, they had a bunch of VR stuff. I don't care, but they had them there. I'm looking at a list of games they have now, basically.
The thing is that I'm wondering how many VR games are going to be supported by the base model of the PS4.
Yeah, that's what I'm wondering
Because
too.
they've
But
got.
I mean, it's the PSVR is coming out this fall, so
Because the
we'll
thing is,
see.
they've got a requirement that they've got to maintain 60 FPS of the whole, like, for the whole
Yeah,
time.
but I mean, the PSVR is launching this fall, and the PS4 Neo isn't
Oh,
even being
yeah.
talked about, so it's like, I guess it'll, guess it gotta work somehow. Riggs is coming there as well. Hawken is coming there. Persona 5, they had at the live cast, which I guess people are excited about that. I
I'm
sure am,
half
but
excited about it.
yeah, same. Like I'm looking forward to it, but it's one of those games where I refuse to get too hyped until I can play it.
And I think in my case, it's also like kind of because what are they called? Studio P now?
Yeah, Studio
They
P, PC,
don't have a
I guess
good
it's.
track record, do they? With certain issues.
Yeah. See how that goes.
Yes.
Yeah, Robinson. There was something called Robinson, which is also like, oh, you're lost in space, maybe VR, cool thing, I guess. I don't know. Here They Lie, something else, blah, blah, blah. There's a bunch of brutal. I think it covered all the big ones, actually. This just seems like smaller stuff.
Yeah.
So that brings us to Nintendo then.
Yeah.
Nintendo only had two games, so
Yes.
it's that one is easy. Let's start with the small game.
Yeah.
I say as I forget what it was
Ever
called.
Oasis.
Ever Oasis, yes, from Grezzo, the
Yes.
people who made the Ocarina of Time 3D
And
remake.
the very good Legend of Legacy. With a ter it's got a
Oh,
terrible name,
what?
but it's a really good game.
Yeah, I didn't know they made that, but okay, cool. So yeah. They're making a game called Ever Oasis, and I think you know more about this than I do,
It's
so go
it
ahead.
looks kind of like a sing I don't know if it I think it is single player, like a single player Fantasy Life kind of game, but obviously not quite so much stuff in it.
Yeah,
Because
not as ambitious.
Fantasy Life is has kind of got a reputation for being a game that no one can finish. It's
Yeah.
got like
It's meant to be a life.
Yes. I mean, from my perspective, I kind of compare it to Final Fantasy 14 because
Yeah.
it is that is a ridiculous amount of stuff to do. I don't really
Yeah.
know much about Ever Oasis. I've seen the trailer, but I don't know much about it. But because it's Grezzo, I am excited.
Yeah, Grezzo's a good studio, so that is nice.
Yeah.
And that's coming out for 3DS.
Yeah.
So that's cool. That's one of the two games.
Yes. Breath of the Wild.
Legend of Zelda: Breath of the Wild. Have you seen much from this?
I saw like half an hour, and then I heard the Anuma thing, and
Oh,
then I
okay, yeah. So
instantly just
you
went,
kind of did what I
and then
did
I
then.
just
But
instantly went, ugh. But
yeah,
then
okay. So.
over the last couple of days, I've been like getting interested in it again.
Yeah, the game looks really good.
Yes, it's.
And I think the highlight for me at the Breath of the Wild presentation was Bill Trinan blowing himself up.
Yes, throwing the, well, he threw a log at a
Yeah,
fire.
he had a stick, because like basically all weapons, like you pick up weapons and like they degrade and break and stuff. So he just picked up a random stick and threw it at an explosive barrel.
Yes.
Which caused a chain reaction of explosions and exploded him.
Yeah, I like because I really like sort of like neat little causal details. So I really like that thing where if you're not wearing, you kick treasure chests.
Open the treasure chest,
Yeah,
and if you don't wear any
use your
shoes,
head.
you hurt your
Yeah.
feet. But yeah, I love the temperature thing. Like, if you're in cold weather, you need to like dress up and stuff like that. Like. I love that. So I mean, it looks to be a really cool little survival sim, which is interesting. Like you can't find hearts in the grass anymore. You eat to get hearts back. You don't. You, I like this. You can hunt animals for food, but you never have to hunt animals for food. So like you can play it as like a pacifist and like someone who doesn't do violence against animals. Like that option is still there, but like it's kind of the Tomb Raider game I wanted when I played Tomb Raider
Yeah,
2013,
see,
and that made me
that was
happy.
another thing I was thinking about was that see, I have problems with the Zelda games. I like bits of them, but I never
Yeah.
tend to like a whole game, like from cover to cover kind of thing.
Yeah.
So I find that if I put a Zelda game down, and I'm in the middle of a... Because I tend to find that I will get bored or distracted or something, or just give up in the middle of a dungeon, and then I'll return to it years later. And then I'll be like, oh, wait, I'd forgotten where I am, and I don't know which doors I've used which keys on and stuff. And yeah. And so I find I lose my place quite easily. So them using sort of like temples, like 100 temples, they said, somewhere in the region, yeah, that are about the...
Over 100 temples.
Over 100 temples that are about the size of the ones in the Tomb Raider reboot. And yeah, that is very much...
That is really yeah, good. And like they said, you can immediately, from 3 hearts at the start, with no equipment, yeah, run to the final boss.
Did they say that?
They don't recommend you doing it, but you can just go straight for the final boss if you want to and see how that goes.
Yeah.
Which is going to create... I mean, that's Soul Level 1 runs, basically, yeah, but for Zelda. Mm. And it's going to be such an exciting game for speedrunners, because, yeah, like, that means you actually have the whole, do I sacrifice speed for strength that might make back the speed or not?
Yeah.
It looks really cool, and, like, I like that they've made item management sort of different, because, like, yeah, now you have to manage, like, your inventory for, like, equipment for items, because, like, weapons will break and you need food. But other things, like, bombs are infinite.
Yeah.
And instead, there's a cooldown on them, and you, yes, have square bombs and round bombs that you can roll or just place that won't roll.
Yeah.
And, like, there's physics on everything, and, like, you can climb walls.
Yeah, I think probably the thing I really liked was that the way that an enemy, like, sort of like did a dive attack towards Link, and in the process, like, cut a tree down.
Yeah.
Things like that. It's really...
Like, yeah, and like, the sword is not like the main combat anymore. Everything is a main combat thing.
Yeah.
Which means that it's not just, no longer see target and then circle strafe until, okay, attack, attack, attack. Mm.
So that, and it makes it...
It's really cool.
It makes it feel kind... I know it won't be, but it makes it feel slightly more like a tabletop RPG kind of thing. Like, it gives just, you more freedom.
I mean, they compared it to Zelda 1 themselves, and it feels very Zelda 1.
Yeah, because...
I do see the Zelda 1 comparison. I think that's a really cool way... Both Zelda and Resident Evil have basically looked at their first game and gone, okay, how can we make this again but different?
Yeah.
And that's really cool. It does feel like the kind of game where, like, this is something they might have imagined back in 86,
mm,
when they first made this. And the game is gorgeous. And I love that, like, that they're even doing, like, some tonal changes. The game doesn't have magic. Instead, everything is tech. It's old,
yeah,
old tech that's coming back to life. So, like, you have, like, bombs. The bombs are technology bombs. Like, yes, they glow with blue outlines and stuff. Like, your bow, like, your fire arrows have, like, this self-igniting thing on them instead of just magic. And, like, it's just so neat. It looks really great. And I'm stoked to play it.
Yeah.
But as of right now, I don't feel I'm going to be buying it on launch because because of Aonuma's,
yes,
fucking bullshit. Because, like, if the listeners haven't heard, which I doubt, but basically, Aonuma commented on the fact that Link is a male character once again, and there's no option for a female character, which, I should point out, I'm fine with. I would have preferred otherwise, but I wasn't going to boycott the game because I had to play as male Link. Mm. However, he commented on why that was, and what he said was, there are 3 quotes, and they get sort of significantly worse in a,
yes,
way.
The new one was said, quite...
The new one was amazing. Yes. But, like, so the first he said, we thought about having a female character. We felt it would just be easier to have Zelda be playable instead. But then we thought, if Zelda is playable, then what would Link do? Yeah. And it's like, the same thing Link is doing.
Yeah.
Or, you know, maybe not do anything. Why does Link have to do something just because Zelda's doing something? What? And then he was like, oh, but, you know, it would mess with the balance of the Triforce if we changed Link into a female character. Like, why would it do that? Link isn't really reincarnated. Like, we've seen Link have to, like, reclaim the Triforce many times at this point, and, like, what?
Yeah.
What are you talking about? Since when is Link's gender a part of the Triforce's balance? There's three parts to it, two male and one female normally. Why would two female, one male suddenly break the balance?
Yeah.
And then the third quote, which came out today, he said, Anuma said, when we were working on Twilight Princess, we made Link appear more masculine. And when we were looking at past Zeldas and designing the new Zelda, I felt that Anuma felt that he should be more androgynous and appear more gender neutral for players to be able to relate to him that way. So we made him more gender neutral.
But he's definitely a guy.
He's definitely a male, however. It's like, wait, you can't say that you made a character more gender neutral for people to easily relate to them, and then a second later go, but he's definitely a man.
Yeah.
Definitely a guy. Like, oh my god. Like, honestly, I as I first read that article, I was like, because when I saw the article pop up, I was like, oh, Anuma says Link is gender neutral. I was like, oh shit, this might actually be a good thing.
Yeah.
And then I read it and was like, wow.
Yeah, I don't get it. I don't think he gets what he's saying.
I mean, the thing is, like, Anuma could easily have said Link is referred to as gender neutral in the game, and they could have quickly done like Control F and just replace all the fucking he, him, boy with neutral words.
And also,
they could have done that and been like, oh, well, Link is gender neutral. Yeah, you can see his nipples, you can see his non nippled breasts in the game, but that's just because Hylians don't have nipples.
Yeah.
Like, it would have been done there. And everyone would have been happy, but no. But the game looks great.
Yeah.
Oh, the game looks fucking incredible.
By the way, because you were someone who really wanted voice acting to be in it.
Yeah.
How do you feel if it is only just the narrator?
Oh, you have no idea how... Okay, so when they first started showing footage and they had voice acting, the first word we hear is, wake up, Link.
Open your eyes.
And I was like, oh, fuck. Because here's the thing, I wanted voice acting.
You wanted good
voice acting. I wanted voice acting that specifically did not name our character.
Yes.
And it seems the only voiced character is the narrator who is constantly saying Link.
Yes.
And it's like, no, this is the opposite of what I wanted. However, Nintendo has
actually
said that...
Do you know what? There is actually there is another game that where the character is specifically named Link. The Face of Evil and...
Yeah. But, like, it's odd, because, like, they did say that, like, Link won't have a voice, but other characters will. So I wonder how many characters will have a voice, and if the Wake Up Link was just a thing for the trailer, and, like, E3 review.
I hope it is,
because I want to name my character.
I would really like them to see what people are thinking, what people are saying. I
mean, they obviously haven't been listening. Obviously, they haven't cared for the last 2 years since we've been saying.
But I'm not gonna. I say hope in the sense that I would wish it to happen, but I'm not expecting it.
Yeah.
I would like them to include just like a slightly more feminine Link, or make an actually gender neutral Link with no pronouns.
Yeah. Kind of thing. By the way, did you see that they have a jump button now? And they were like, oh yeah, for the first time in the Zelda game, you can jump. And I was like, Zelda 2. Guys, come on.
And Faces of Link. Face of Evil.
Faces of Link.
Faces of Link.
Like, Zelda 2, not to mention the feather in the Game Boy games.
Yeah.
Come on. But yeah, looks great. I think the game's going to be swell.
Yeah. I think I was because of it being an NX game, a lot of people were like, me included, were worried that it was going to look kind of like bad now
on the Wii U.
On the Wii U. But
yeah, it looks really good on the Wii U.
So yeah, I'm looking forward to what the NX version is.
Yeah, considering Nintendo had fucking nothing to show at E3, they better have a lot to show for NX this fall.
Mm.
I mean, and by the way, they didn't even show Metroid Prime Federation Force.
No, I think they know people don't want it. When
I was waiting actually, for it. Like, come on.
Wait, sorry, you keep talking. I'll look up when it's actually coming out.
Because I had a thing on my bingo board here saying Samus Aran revealed for Metroid Prime Federation Force.
Oh.
Which, you know, is the easy way to just solve all the issues people had with it. It's going, oh, actually, there is a Samus Aran mission. Basically. And like, oh, and if you finish it, you can play as Samus Aran in the main campaign. There, you have been done. So I was just waiting for 3 days for like, okay, today is the day with Federation Force. And then, like, day three happens, I'm like, where's the Nintendo stream? And I tweet out, like, shouldn't the Nintendo stream have started? And people are like, oh, Nintendo only streamed 2 days this year. Mm. Like, wait, what?
Yeah.
Oh, dear.
So, yeah, apparently that's out in September.
Wow.
So, yeah, it's because it's from Next Level Games, I am... It will probably be a good game. In terms of hopefully. In terms of play wise, it will be good. In terms of because I saw a boss fight, that I kind of like the mechanics of, but the actual, you know, the fact that it is a Metroid game and doesn't have Samus is a little disappointing.
30th anniversary celebration.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know. But yeah, they did show some other games at the Nintendo Treehouse though, like third party stuff. Dragon Quest VII was there; it looks great.
Yeah.
You had Yo-Kai Watch 2.
Yeah.
Which is gonna have two versions.
And it's not gonna be coming out in Europe for ages.
Probably not. I think they showed something else I liked, but I can't remember it. And then it was Pokemon Sun and Moon, of course, which, you know, it's Pokemon.
Yeah.
I'm not sure what else to say about it.
It doesn't look better than the recent reveal trailer.
Yeah, it's like it's Pokemon. Litten's the best starter.
Yeah. I'll look up the schedule, see if there's anything we missed. Oh, yeah, what do you think of the new Mario Party?
Oh, yeah. I forgot about that.
Because they moved back.
It's another handheld Mario Party. It's like, we don't like these. Just give us a proper Mario Party already, Nintendo.
Well, they're at least moving back to... They're moving nearer back to the old kind of...
No, but they did that with Island Tour or whatever it was called as well.
No. No, because that was like... That had... Didn't Island Tour have like a more of a straight line kind of like... Eight, yeah,
but it wasn't the car thing.
Yes, but this seems to be sort of like the problem was I looked at them and it looked like overly regimented, like grid based stuff, and so I was like, well, I mean, at least are you giving us choice of where to go?
Yeah, and the problem is like no one want to play a Mario Party game on handheld because it's a couch game.
See. It's a
board game on the TV where you're sitting around looking at the same thing at the same time, nudging each other and having fun. It would be nice to have an online mode.
I understand that, but yeah. You're also talking to someone who has exclusively played Mario Party 2 solo.
Okay.
Yeah.
Because I've said it before, like the one thing that would redeem a Mario Party game for me on handhelds is if it had online. Which... I'm going to guess this one won't have either, because it's Nintendo.
Yeah, give me a moment. I'll keep talking. I'll have a look.
I don't think I'm stuck about the Mario Party 9 is boring.
What was it even called? So it's 10.
It's called Star Rush.
Star Rush.
Yeah.
Mario Party SpaghettiOs, or whatever it was.
Oh yeah, the cover art for Mario Party Star Rush is reused art book from the SpaghettiOs that they had in America. It's like, really? You could even make a new 3D render for this game?
Right, come on. Right, I'm gonna do a find on page for online. No, no results.
Okay. Well, anyway, I think that's E3 this year.
Think of anything else. I don't know if it was at E3 or before, but I think it was before. They announced the new expansion to Destiny.
Oh, yeah.
Rise of Iron.
Yeah, Rise of Iron. And they also announced, they finally showed gameplay for Mafia 3, which, by the way, looks fucking amazing.
Yeah. It's... Basically, because I don't like that kind of game anyway, I probably won't get it. But it does look better than your GTAs and stuff.
Well, yeah, the story itself just looks really
interesting. It has a good story, seemingly.
But yeah, it seems like Destiny is finally getting back on track.
That's good.
Yeah, because the thing was that I don't know if you've read up on the development history. And that,
not really.
But basically, what was meant to be happening, what the contract the Bungie were given was going to be, like, over the course of 10 years, they were going to make one game, and then every 2 years, and then, like, in the off years, they were going to do expansions. So basically, the Taken King was all of the content that was meant to be in the base game. It, like, everything up to the Taken King, is that's what that is. And they've, I like that they've, because the first year they released Destiny and then they did two, like, DLC expansions that were, like,
yeah,
they were, like a, you know, a small amount of money. But they seem to have moved more towards free content patches now.
Okay, that's cool.
So yeah, it seems like the idea of paying for like, you know, instead of paying like a monthly subscription or whatever, you're paying for like a 25 quid expansion, which seems pretty good.
I was so disappointed because, like, I really liked Destiny when I played it in beta and alpha, but like when it came out and like everyone basically agreed that like the game had no content at launch, and I was just so like I just lost all my interest because I was like, oh man, I'm looking forward to playing Destiny in a few months when I have time for it and I can play it. And people like got tired of it in less than a week. And I was like, oh wow. But this was going to be so amazing.
I think you should buy the Legendary Edition when you can.
Yeah, I've been thinking about it because I did like it.
Because obviously it's got all the stuff in it, and also it's now going a bit cheaper. It's kind of like 25 quid for all things in it, and I liked it a lot.
Honestly, I kind of wish it was on PC. Like, that's, I don't really get why they didn't put it on PC.
Well, yeah. But then again, the same. Sorry, my brain going in tangents again. I'm thinking about how, like, the Division on PC has been like hacked to hell and back. So maybe they were trying to avoid that. I don't know.
Maybe. I don't know. I'm just like I'm fine with console FPS games.
Yeah,
I'm fine playing FPS games with a controller. I just prefer not doing it. You know, so it's like, especially that I've been playing Doom. I've been playing. I've been meaning to play Wolfenstein: The Order again and stuff like this. And I've been playing with PC shooters. I'm like, oh man, I don't want to really go back and play one of them on consoles. It feels odd. I don't know. I mean, I think we summed up E3 well enough. I think it was pretty good E3. What would you say was your personal like game of show?
Oh, I don't know. Yeah, it's difficult to say because I barely watched it. I mean, I mostly experienced it through, you know, other people's tweets. Nothing really seemed to get announced this year.
It was mostly just confirmations of games we were already waiting for. Yeah.
So I don't know, Dragon Quest VII. the fact that we're getting it is the game of E3.
That is pretty amazing. Yeah. Yeah. I don't know. Like, there's a lot of games I was really impressed by at E3. But I suppose like the big one for me in the end would have to still be probably Final Fantasy XV. Because, I mean, I've been on board with that game for almost all of its marketing campaign, and I still think it looks absolutely great. RE7 was a nice surprise as well. And I guess the running up price goes to John Carmack playing Minecraft.
Yeah.
So, anything you want to plug?
I've got a YouTube channel, Somniferous Lothy. You can watch that if you want. It's basically, recently I've done nothing really. I've just been like uploading streams through PlayStation Share when I've been playing things, and I've not been doing like commentary or anything. I've just been playing. So the last thing I did was like an LP type thing, which is the second part of Trails of Cold Steel.
Oh yeah.
So, you know, if you want to watch that, I've kind of done an LP of Dark Souls, but there's like 4 videos missing because I accidentally deleted loads of footage, and then also two of the videos were just bad.
Yeah, I know that feeling far too well. Oh my god, I fucking hate that.
So yeah,
and you can, of course, if you're listening to this, you are watching my YouTube channel, so I don't need to plug that.
Yeah,
but my Twitter is onreritsu in one word, and I'll probably be writing some pretty downbeat articles about companies at
E3. Will that be on you?
On my.
I was going to say, will that be on your Tumblr or your WordPress?
Probably my WordPress. So on reritsu.wordpress.com for that. But yeah, thank you for listening. And this has been the 5th annual E3 podcast. So 5 years. Holy shit.
Yeah.
That's cool. Time flies. Bye.
Bye.